Episode 28. Let's go.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Permadeath Podcast. Episode 28.
Long time no see, guys. How have you been?
Yeah. Oh, my God. It's been years.
It's been a while.
It's been like half an hour. It's been...
I really wasn't committed to that bit.
No. A half an hour and some waffles later, we're ready to
waffles,
talk about...
Waffles? You were getting cereal. What happened, man?
I went down to the kitchen, and I'm standing there, and I'm like, well, I don't know if I really want Frosted Flakes right now. So I turned around. I want to look for something quick. I look in the freezer. There's a box of waffles. I'm like, sure.
Eggos?
Yes.
Okay.
Extra fluffy.
I presume that's like... The pastry's fluffy, not like they've got fluff on them.
No, yeah, it's yeah, they're thicker.
Mm. I do like a thick waffle.
Anyway, we're here to talk about the Nintendo Switch conference.
Yes.
That Nintendo just
and
put
the,
on
and the week that has followed.
Because it's yeah.
An interesting week.
It's an interesting conference. It's Nintendo's first live
stage in
years since they started doing their directs.
When was their last E3? Was it 2014 or 2013?
I don't know.
I think it might be 2013.
2013 sounds right.
When did they? Was the Wii U the last one?
Yeah.
The last time they were ever on stage was revealed, or did they do one after that?
Oh, they might have done one after, you know. Because the Wii U came out in 2012, didn't it?
Yeah, it came out before the PS4 and Xbox.
Christmas 2012. So I think that they might have had one after that.
Regardless, it's been a long time. They've been sticking to the directs, which I actually really enjoy the directs. I think that was actually kind of a cool move for them. I think the more controlled nature of the directs and the way that they've done them for E3, and they're really enjoyable. So
there
was
one moment in the presentation that really cements why you should have a direct and not
was
a live
presentation.
No, not the sofa. It was Suda 51.
Oh my
the translator. That I feel so bad for that guy.
Okay.
Apparently,
I was talking to Matt about it yesterday, and apparently, what Suda was saying just didn't
no,
make
it,
any
it doesn't,
sense.
Yeah,
so
Matt,
he was
Matt
like,
read out
the
translation. It legitimately makes no sense.
A lot
so I feel
of the,
so bad for that guy, but
as far as I know, a lot of the stuff is like pre-written. Like they give the translators like a general gist, I believe. So
yeah,
like they aren't left in the
just
dust.
Just ignored it.
Yeah, it went off. I mean, that's Suda, but I mean like for you, but like totally. I actually think that portion of the conference was could have done well. I mean, like I am super hyped that they announced that, like another No More Heroes game. But like it was kind of.
No, we'll get onto that in a bit. Yeah. We'll get onto that in a
okay.
bit. But carry on.
That Suda announced a game. We can say.
But it was.
No, we'll get onto it in a bit. Stop.
It was very reminiscent to me of like a Kojima moment, where like there's nothing there, for me to get excited about besides the prospect of it. But yeah, sorry, the Switch conference.
Yeah.
In general, back at the beginning.
Way back in the beginning, they announced a price. And that price was $299.99 US dollars, 279 English.
It hits that sweet spot that everyone was talking about.
Yeah, I think some people,
aside from like people who don't understand how video games work, where they're like, it's got to be £100 or otherwise it's going to fail.
I understand. People's biggest complaint is that it's £280 without a bundle in game. I understand that, but I also understand why it's £280 and they want to make a profit on it, because they said they aren't going to make a loss, at least to begin with. And if they wanted to include a game, it would have pushed it closer to that £300 mark, which would have been a little bit hard to swallow. I think people were hoping that it would be £250 for a base bundle and then £280 with a game.
Which Reggie went out and explained and said
yeah.
the reason that it doesn't come packed in with the game is because we wanted to keep the price down. And
like they wanted nice round $300. Which I totally get. It's annoying, but...
See, but they keep the price down, but you still got to buy a game.
You do, but
yeah,
you don't...
Yeah, well, you could use that money that you would have saved on having the bundle in title and put it towards a game that you'll actually use at the same time. Because I know, personally, if... I know 1-2 Switch is the one that everyone's saying this should have been a bundle game. Like, they should have bundled this with the console. I don't know how many times I'd use 1-2 Switch. Like, it looks like an interesting game, but aside from when I see my friends, which is not all that often, I'm never going to use it.
I think Wii Sports had that single player element. It could be played with multiple people, but you could play it on your own. Nintendo Land had a single player element. 1-2 Switch is all about the multiplayer. It shows off the features of the Switch, but it doesn't work without multiple people.
I think that's why I would prefer it as a packing game, because I would never buy it. Like, and I know that's like maybe selfish, but at the same time, like when they first like announced it, like that was like one of the first new game they showed off at the conference was 1-2 Switch.
Yes.
Like after they showed off like the whole Ice Cube thing
stuff.
And
The first game that they showed was 1-2 Switch.
Like as I'm watching, I'm like, this looks really fun. Like it looks like one of those like goofy like WarioWare, like Nintendo type ideas. It's like that. It isn't like something that would sell anybody on anything, and like maybe someone wouldn't go out and buy that necessarily, but it looks like one of those fun things where it's like, hey, look, you know, the HD rumble and like the motion tracking and like all the different things that the Joy-Cons and the IR sensors and all those little things do and everything. Like that'd be a really fun game. Like you buy the Switch and it's like, you could like, since it's portable, you could take that literally anywhere, 1-2 Switch, and put it on the table and everybody's playing it. I think it's a good demonstration of not just the portability of it and that, like, look, you really can take this anywhere. It's a great party game because you don't need a TV to play it. You don't even use a TV to play it, as far as I understand. You're never really even looking at the screen. And, like, and it demonstrates the Joy-Con so well. Like, just how, like...
how the system works.
Yeah, how tightly tuned the rumble thing and the motion tracking really do work on the Joy-Cons. They are really cool tech. So, like, I was expecting it to be a packing game. But even if it's not a packing game, like, I also wasn't expecting it to be like $50 either, at least here. At least I assume.
Yeah, it's £40 here, which is I've got my
calculator up.
No, did I get rid of? Did I get rid of it? No, I didn't. So it's £50 here, is it?
Yeah.
No, it's 40.
Yeah. Oh, is it 40 here?
I think so. Let me just double check.
£49.52.
So it's about $50 here. 1-2 Switch, £40 here. I think that at that price, the issue we have is that they only showed off 5 mini games total. If you watch the Treehouse,
they hinted that there'd be a lot more.
If you watch in the actual trailer, it looks like there's probably close to 15, 20. It's hard to tell, but you don't have any clue what they are. So you're basing it on the fact that you saw Milk, sandwich eating, table tennis. The samurai sword and the ball guessing game.
Yeah, the game in general, go ahead.
I was just gonna say, so from that perspective, it feels like you're paying £8 for each of those little games, because you don't have the perspective of how much there is actually in the game. You don't know. Oh, sorry, and the quick draw one.
Oh yeah, the McCree game.
That one looked fun.
I
was watching the reaction that happened at the Nintendo World Store in New York.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as like the Cowboys came on screen, just one dude in the back just went, "It's high noon."
For a brief moment, we were like, "Is that Red Dead? Is this Red Dead?"
Yeah, apparently Matt was having a heart attack thinking it was Red Dead Redemption.
It would have been cool if it was, but that would have been the weirdest first game.
Yeah.
Well,
I think what excites me about like the game in general is the concept of 1-2 Switch and like why I'm like personally bummed. Like either it's not packed in or it's not a little cheaper. Is that like like over the last 2 years, like Jackbox has become a huge thing, a huge hit with everybody, and like that whole idea of everybody in the room playing a party game has like come back. Like, thanks to these new things. And, like, I think the Switch has so much potential for that type of thing, because you can bring it anywhere, and you are bringing the console with you when you bring that tablet. I think it's so cool. And, like, I think the idea of 1-2 Switch, like, putting it down on the table, there's no way a room's not going to have fun with that. Watching people make an ass out of themselves, Michael Cow, or, like, the Quick Draw game, or the Quick Draw one, like, a lot of potential there, like, for that to be, like a surprise hit. I know a lot of people are making fun of it or whatever. But, like, I think anyone making fun of that, I think there's, like, things to be disappointed with the combo. Like, that's not one. Like one thing to make fun of is not 1-2 Switch. Like, I love WarioWare, and I love that quirky look. Like, and 1-2 Switch, like, could conceptually be a WarioWare game. If you put WarioWare on it, I wouldn't be surprised. That's it's very reminiscent of that, like, to me, that zaniness, like WarioWare Feel the Magic or what have you. But
that being said, like, with 1-2 Switch, I probably will pick it up towards the end of the year.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm not in a rush to get it. I'll probably pick it up towards Christmas.
I'll pick it up at launch because I've pre-ordered it, because I figured it'll be a nice thing to sort of try. I'm curious to see how many people buy it and then trade it in, and what the sort of trade-in market on that is. Because the thing with the Wii U was, no one liked Nintendo Land, so there were hundreds of copies of Nintendo Land traded in, and they were dirt cheap. I'm curious to see how much 1-2 Switch retains its value.
I hope it's a bit cheaper by the end of the year, because I want to get it for Christmas so I can play it with my family, because me and my family don't really have that much in common, but maybe we can play some video games together and that'll be fine. But it's not like I need to have this game right this second, like I need it or anything. It's just I'd like to play it with my family, because I think that looks like the sort of game that maybe my grandma could get on board with.
Yeah. And that's why it was so surprising that it wasn't like included in some form, even in a bundle, like a separate bundle.
Like a more expensive bundle.
Yeah. Just because it is one of those things that anybody can play that. Like, anybody could figure out, oh, I got to milk the cow. You know, just like with Wii Sports, anybody can toss a bowling ball. It looks fun, though. For sure.
And then the next game was Arms.
Yes.
Arms is a game that looks to me to be really quite interesting, and I am interested in playing it. However, it's too expensive. This is going to be like one of the big points with me, is that it's just, as a lot of these games are just too expensive. So this game is £50 in the UK, which is $61. Which, if it's selling for $60 in the US, then fair enough. But I don't know that I'd want to pay that much money for a game that I'll probably play a couple times and then be like, okay, that was fun.
Yeah.
Again, I feel like they've done a disservice by only showing a limited player set of I think they showed 5, because each one has...
Does Arms have a release date?
It's launch window.
Yeah, I don't know the date exactly.
Let me double check. I had it a second ago.
Because maybe they're just, like, not completely ready to show off the characters. Which should be concerning if it was launch day, but I don't think it is.
Nope, I can't find it.
Although the music for Arms was awesome.
It was such a weird intro.
Arms has the potential to be like a Splatoon situation, where if they treat it well enough and nurture it well enough, and like it like latches on with like kind of how Splatoon latched on with like shooter fans or non-shooter fans, or like you can get into this without having to be an amazing, you don't have to shoot anybody. I mean, obviously Arms, you're gonna have to actually fight, but I mean, like, you don't maybe have to be like a super technical, awesome fighting game fan to play it. And
that's true. Yeah,
I think if they like nurture it well and like support it, and like there's a good roster of characters people can identify with, kind of like an Overwatch situation, I think Arms has. I really liked what I saw of Arms.
Did you watch the Treehouse, Bill?
No, but I watched some coverage of it from like the New York events and stuff like that. Okay. Not necessarily the Treehouse, but I did watch a few stuff after.
So, it comes out in spring. It's not got a date. It's just spring. So,
like, I want to play it because it looks fun. Like, everything I've heard about Arms, everyone's been saying it's really fun.
It's
like,
more fun than it looks.
It's more fun than it looks. The motion gyro controls, whatever, work really, really well.
They're also optional.
Woo! Yeah, that too.
They didn't make a point of, like, no one mentioned that until, like, you started coming out of that event, and people were like, actually, you can turn off the controls, we just don't know how it plays like that, because they wanted us to play it like motion controls. But it looked like it works well, that it doesn't follow the Wii boxing tactic of flail your arms and you'll win.
Mm-hmm.
There is actually some skill in it. It's like a... And each hero has two ult loadouts for their for each fist. So
yeah, that
seems really cool.
Yeah, what I was saying was I want to play it because everyone's been saying that it looks really fun, but I don't know how it is in terms of single player. Because again, it's a 1-2 switch situation with if it's a multiplayer game pretty exclusively, when am I going to use it? Because
yeah.
I feel like 1-2 switch is an easy sell for my family at Christmas. ARMS, not so much.
They didn't announce whether there was going to be any online support for it, so it's like all we saw of it was like split screen play, wasn't there?
Oh no. If there's no online, no. Let's see.
That's what I'm saying. I don't know.
It's going to be one of those things where I've just got to wait for more information, but
a lot of the announced games are a case of I will probably buy it close to when it comes out just because everything I saw looks interesting. I don't want to support that sort of stuff, but
there's an online mode.
There is? Okay, yes. Cool. Sweet.
So I can beat you up over the internet then.
Yep.
Okay. Okay. Well, ARMS is one of those things that I just don't know at the minute. I'll probably wait a little bit to see.
Mm.
Again, because I'm trying to save money this year.
Yeah.
Not a great year to be saving money when there's a new console coming out that I really want, but I'm going to try not to buy everything. And ARMS is, like, really quite low priority for me, just because I don't know. I want it to be successful like Splatoon was, but if everyone buys it and everyone's playing it, then I'll be like, well, I'll buy ARMS then.
Yeah.
Still think the name's a bit weak, but...
Yeah.
I mean, I guess the point across. I want the sequel.
ARMS.
ARMS.
Eggs.
What was next? Was it Splatoon next? In terms of games.
In terms of games, I think it probably was. It was either Splatoon or Mario Kart.
They didn't show Mario Kart at the presentation.
Correct. So it was Splatoon. Why? Not called Splatoon, unfortunately, but...
With the 2 instead of the T-O-O.
Like Banjo-Tooie. But no, it's Splatoon 2. It looks amazing.
That surprised me, honestly.
What, that it was called Splatoon 2?
Well, not in a bad way, but I mean, like it looks like more Splatoon, you know. But and
new
like
maps, new weapons.
Yeah.
Did you think they were going to go the Mario Kart route and it'd be like a port rather than a sequel?
Because I was totally convinced that the turnaround on Splatoon 2 is fast as hell. Like that came out 2 years ago. I mean, it's not that quick, but I mean, like in the span of the way how Nintendo usually operates or with their sequels and everything and. Like it was a fast turnaround.
I imagine it's one of those things that they could quite regularly pump out content for, just because really you've got the mechanics down. It's just map design,
and a few
tweaks for new weapons and things.
I think it's really important that this is Splatoon 2 and not a port. I think you know, like one of their most successful IPs of recent years, and like Splatoon was a smash hit. It took a lot of people by surprise. It was huge in Japan, which is really important, especially for this, which is a handheld as well. Handhelds are huge in Japan. Japan loves Splatoon. To have Splatoon on a portable is massive for over there. And it's awesome for here as well. But like for over there, that's huge. So I think it's important that the Splatoon releases a sequel. I think getting Splatoon 2 out and expanding on that and having that be the Splatoon for the Switch platform is a lot cooler than just having like Splatoon Deluxe or something like that. Whereas, you know, there's going to be another sequel coming out. Whereas, no, this is Splatoon 2. This is Splatoon. They will have all the Splatfest in here. You're not going to have to worry about playing the Splatoon port and then moving over to 2 and then possibly losing whatever. Like, no, this is Splatoon 2. Like, there's enough in there that they considered a sequel, and there's enough that I've seen that I would consider it a sequel. I was expecting the Mario Kart route, so I was pleasantly surprised when that awesome dude came out and announced Splatoon 2. that guy was amazing.
Hello, I'm from the Squid Research Facility, because we still haven't let go of this joke, but I don't know how many people appreciate.
And the game looks fantastic.
New story.
Hopefully that means new single player, because I loved the single players with
Doom
1.
Campaign was awesome.
New music, and then new customization options, new I want to call them ultimates, but they're not called ultimates.
I think they're called supers or specials, I can't remember.
specials probably sounds about right.
So in the game there
they've gotten rid of basically everything in terms of like Killer Whale and the Ink Strike isn't there. And
No Kraken.
Instead, they've just like completely redone them, which is pretty cool because I was like, I wonder how they're going to do that because the Ink Strike at the very least requires you to use the touch screen and you can't have dual screen play with the Switch, as far as I understood it at the time anyway.
You still can.
This is a day one buy for me as well.
Did you guys mention New Hub World at all?
No,
because it looks like it's going to be a bigger city from what we're seeing there, and that excites me a lot. I think they're going to take that even like a step further than how it was in the first game. Like, I think it would be really neat if it took a Destiny route and we actually see players running around in there. I think that would be really neat. Although I really liked the way they had it in Splatoon 1 with like the Miiverse posts and stuff, but seemingly the Miiverse is gone.
The Miiverse doesn't exist anymore.
You guys know how much that bums me out in a way. Like, I really liked the Miiverse. I think it was really endearing, like going to certain games like Miiverse, like message board or whatever, and seeing posts for like 3D World by like little kids, like I can't beat this level, and I loved seeing that because I could just imagine like a little Bill or like a little, like, you know, like going on and like posting on this thing like I can't beat this. Does anybody love the graphics? And it's like I just love it. I loved the Miiverse a lot. I think it had a lot of personality. I would have been neat to expand on that.
Endearing moment to me about the Miiverse.
And it's
a sad moment, but when Iwata passed away, the Miiverse was in every game, was an amazing sort of community. Just a community outpouring, but also
tributes and stuff. Yeah,
and just the creativity of people of linking that to the game they were playing, be it Mario Kart, Smash Brothers, or Splatoon. And Splatoon implemented that so well in the form of, like, in the maps, the graffiti was pasted everywhere and around Inkopolis, and it was just like, this is really cool. I don't have to be looking at squids to see what they're drawing. It's everywhere.
I really hope they have something in place for Miiverse. I mean, admittedly, there's not many details on the online portion of this thing, and
you're not even required to have a Mii for the Switch either.
So that kind of bums me out too, in a way. Like, there's aspects of like the Wii U that I love, and the Miiverse, and in fact, things about Nintendo that I love. Like, I actually really like Miis, and now, admittedly, we don't know much about the online or whatever. So, like, you know, and there's lots of rumors flying around.
It seems
around.
Like you can have Miis. It's just they're not required.
Yeah. That makes sense if they're trying to detach
move away from.
But I just loved the fact that there was this community inside of your console with the Miiverse, and like it was active. Like people were posting art like all the time. Like people would draw really cool shit with the gamepad. Like blew me away.
I never use it because I felt wholly inadequate. But
like I thought it was really neat that there were all these communities and they were active. And like you can go to the Monster Hunter one for Monster Hunter 3, and like there's people like, hey, you want to play? It's like, yeah. It's like, that's cool. So I hope they do something similar to that, because that was like more, that was better than whatever any, like, that's better than the community system they have on PS4. That's better than what they've got on the Xbox. Like, the Miiverse was really something cool. And it gave us a Twitter account, Bad Miiverse Posts, which I really enjoyed a lot.
Is that a thing? Bad Miiverse Posts?
Yes, go through that Twitter. It will make your life.
I really hope that I'm not on there for any of my drawings.
it's mostly strange ones posted by kids. Like, it'll be like, oh, I can't beat this level, and my mom's yelling at my dad, like, and like this stuff like that, or it's like kind of sad.
Yeah.
But it's some really funny ones on there as well. It's a really good Twitter. Miiverse was a gold mine.
But Splatoon 2 does not have a date yet. It's just summer. I can't remember who I was talking to. I don't even remember if it was in the last episode what I expect the sales will be like for the Switch.
I was talking to Andy about it.
Okay, yeah. So I imagine that day one or week one or whatever, it's pretty much just going to be people who really want to play Zelda on it. Slash diehard Nintendo fans who are just like, I need to get it day one.
Yeah.
There'll be a small bump when Mario Kart comes out, I think. The bigger bump will be in the summer when Splatoon 2 comes out, because at that point we got Zelda, Mario Kart, Splatoon 2, and Snipperclips. And then the biggest jump will be at Christmas, because A, it's Christmas,
Mario.
And Mario, and Skyrim, and more of the third-party stuff.
Yeah, I think it's a good point, and I think we'll probably get a Mario release date at E3, probably, unless they choose to do a separate Direct for it either before or after. Like, I think summer we will
see. Speaking of Mario, Mario was the next game that they went into, so we might as well just
keep going.
Talk about that now.
Yeah.
3D Mario come back. Happy.
It looks in New Donk City.
It looks
New Donk City.
Amazing.
I still think Mario looks friggin' weird when he's next to normal people.
I mean,
he's only up to their knees.
It's
and
strange.
Like,
does that imply like Mario's an alien or something? That like he's not a real
human. He's just very short.
I mean, but he's also like a different color than them. Like in everything.
Yeah. I mean, you don't have to bring race into it.
And he's also got like a different nose. And like,
I like that they're sort of going back to Mario's roots, because he was always a character that was originally from Brooklyn. Which apparently Kinross didn't know.
No.
Until I mentioned it, but he's from New York originally, so when I saw New Donk City, I was like, is this the new overworld for Splatoon? and then like Mario popped out and I was like, yay! Because I'm not a huge fan of, I'll say this time and time again, 2D Mario games. I didn't grow up with them. The first Mario game I ever played was Mario 64, and I've always found more enjoyment in 3D Marios as opposed to either old Mario games or the new Super Mario Brothers series. So I'm excited that I finally get to play a Mario game for the first time in forever that's a single-player experience, because the last time I got one of those was
Sunshine, because I didn't actually play Galaxy
until quite recently, and even then I didn't like it particularly because of the perspective on some of the maps and stuff. Sunshine on the GameCube. So everyone's like super attached to Mario as a character and as a franchise, and I'm like, I don't hate him.
It looks great.
Yeah.
Game
looks
beautiful. It looks really, really good.
Game looks really nice.
Bowser looks sharp. Nice suit.
Pimp Bowser.
Yeah.
I saw someone posted a picture of there's like a poster in the game of Mario and Peach, not Mario and Peach's, Bowser and Peach's wedding.
Yes.
And someone posted a picture of that on Twitter with just "I write sins, not tragedies" as like the tagline.
Oh,
Panic at the Disco reference.
Nice.
I'm excited for the new Mario
3D open world sandbox is what they're calling it.
Sandbox.
Where you fly a hat ship and you can jump on your hat.
I hope that I like it as much as I like Mario 64.
I imagine it'll be, because 64 holds that nostalgic spot for you, I imagine it'll be better than Sunshine, not quite as good as 64.
Yeah, but you know me and nostalgia, and I'm not. It doesn't really hinder me that much when it comes to games, because
I mean,
Black and White to Pokemon Red and Blue.
You were pretty reluctant to let go of your best game ever, though, for nostalgia reasons. You're like, it's been my best game ever for so long. I can't.
I did let go of it though.
Eventually, it was reluctant.
Yeah, because I like No More Heroes. It's a good game. And when I was playing it again the other day, I was like, oh man, I love this game. Anyway, moving on from Mario, was it the sequence after this where they announced, like, all of my wishes?
I think so, yes.
So they announced Xenoblade Chronicles 2.
That. Yeah.
Which, because they're calling it Xenoblade Chronicles 2, I'm thinking it's more like the original Xenoblade Chronicles than it is Xenoblade Chronicles X.
Yeah, that's the vibe I got.
The world looks so amazing and so great.
I will watch someone play it.
I cannot wait for Xenoblade Chronicles 2. And this one was probably like the biggest surprise for me, because Xenoblade Chronicles X didn't come out that long ago. And as far as I was aware,
didn't
Monolith...
do that well. Did it?
No, I think it did pretty well. I think you're talking about FE Shop, because we've spoken about how FE Shop didn't do very well before. But as far as I was aware, like, a lot of staff at Monolith Soft had been working on Breath of the Wild with Nintendo. So I was like, oh, a new Monolith game. They do Xenoblade. And I didn't realize it was Xenoblade Chronicles related at all until Kinross pointed out that he saw a Nopon. Yeah, it's Xenoblade Chronicles 2, and it looks great. And I can't wait to see how it sort of attaches itself to Xenoblade Chronicles enough to make it a direct sequel.
Yeah. I wonder if
Which is interesting, because, like, the ending of Xenoblade Chronicles was open, but I wouldn't have said they could have made an entirely new game off of it.
I wonder if it will be, like hundreds of years later. Have they given any story details at all?
I will say one thing that I'm not crazy about with what I've seen in Xenoblade Chronicles 2 is the fact that it looks so anime.
It looks really anime, yeah.
It does, doesn't it? Because, like, Xenoblade Chronicles sort of went for, like, a realistic-ish sort of style. It didn't work particularly well, but that's sort of art style they were going for. So I assumed that if they did anything else, it would be sort of similar to that. And then Xenoblade Chronicles X had sort of, like, a mix of both sort of realistic features and anime. And now this is just straight-up anime. They just look like anime characters, so... I don't know how I feel about that, but everything else I can't wait for. That's a day one purchase for me whenever that happens.
Sorry.
Yeah, that was an exciting announcement that I wasn't expecting to happen. And for it to be two, and for it to be a sequel like that.
Yeah.
Because I think I remember him stating or something that he wouldn't do one, or like that he wasn't gonna do one, like or something like that. Or something I read about the Xenoblade franchise and how there wouldn't be a sequel. I gotta look that up.
Apparently only 850,000 units.
That's pretty good.
What is that for X?
Yeah.
For a JRPG, that's
I suppose
as hell, that's
on a Wii U
good.
As well. Yeah, I forgot that it was on the Wii U. I was like, man, it sold 11,000 units in Japan.
Oh, he was talking about X. He was talking about X. Ah. My bad. About that, it won't be a sequel.
Okay.
Anyway.
And then after Xenoblade Chronicles 2...
I was already having a heart attack at this point.
Warriors?
Yeah, it was Fire Emblem Warriors. I went through a range of emotions when that trailer happened.
I'm really disappointed that we weren't recording this, because for this moment alone... the moment that you realised that it was Xenoblade, and you're like... And then you see a blue orb with a falchion in it, and you're like,
"No, it wasn't even before that. It was
The Team Ninja,
the Team Ninja Koei Tecmo sort of like splash screens came up, and I was like, "Oh, are they doing a new Hyrule Warriors thing?" And then I saw the falchion in the like little blue orb, and I was like, "It's happening! It's finally happening! The game that I wanted is happening! Oh my god!" I was freaking out. I was absolutely freaked out. Because I mentioned this in the last podcast that we just recorded, but a while ago, I don't know what episode, we were asked a question about our sort of dream games, or our dream crossover games, and I said Warriors with Fire Emblem.
Yeah.
And I thought that would have been amazing, but I didn't actually expect it to happen. So I'm excited to see where that goes. They've sort of shown off a little bit of gameplay of that now as well.
Yeah.
And I'm not too blown away by how the character models look. I think it looks okay, but I was expecting like Hyrule Warrior level sort of design changes and stuff, and it's literally just Crom as he was in Fire Emblem Awakening. So it'd be interesting to see if they do change any characters up, and I'm assuming they're going to be bringing in like popular characters like Lin from Fire Emblem 6 or 7. Probably bring in Roy, Marth will be there, did I just say Roy? Meant Ike.
Yeah.
Ike will probably be there because they're the Smash Bros. Characters, and basically, any character that anyone has ever said, oh, you should put them in Smash, they'll probably be in this, like, they have a really big range of characters to choose from. There's like 600 Fire Emblem characters or something. So
I enjoyed Hyrule Warriors on the Wii U enough that I'll pick it up. I didn't enjoy it so much on the 3DS, but it was a nice cathartic slashing game.
Yeah.
I got nowhere near I didn't play anywhere near as much of the map as you. I played the story
mode,
yeah. And
I was determined to finish that, and I never did it. I never did it because it was just like so
was
hard
ridiculous.
Towards the end.
But yeah, I will probably pick this up. Maybe launch day. We'll see how it's looking. It comes out this autumn.
This is a launch day for me, for yeah. sure. Right. Same with Xenoblade Chronicles. Fire Emblem is for sure.
Yeah, Xenoblade doesn't even have a window at the minute, but...
I imagine that'll be late 2018. I can't imagine that being any sooner.
Yeah.
That's just me personally. But and then they had like the third party section where they spoke about Shin Megami Tensei,
mm-hmm.
which... Probably the closest I've played to a Shin Megami Tensei game is FE Shop, so yep. I don't know if Bill's got any.
That's exciting. I played a bit of 4 on the 3DS on a bus trip once. I never played more of it than that, but I really like it. I think the Mega Ten games are really cool in that they offer really neat ways to like form a party, like especially in Shin Megami Tensei, like the mainline series, opposed to Persona, whereas Persona like. You have, like, your friends and your social links, and you're also getting Persona and, like, demons that way, infusing them. Whereas Shin Megami Tensei, with the mainline series, your party is primarily made up of demons. And, like, there's really cool ways to, like, recruit them into your party, like, through conversation and, like, and stuff like that. I can't go too in-depth because I don't know that much. But they're darker than the Persona games and usually a little more apocalyptic than what we get in Persona. And they're really neat, though. So that's really cool that presumably Nintendo's going to keep having dibs on the mainline franchise, because Shin Megami Tensei 4 was, like, a mainline release on a 3DS, and that was a big deal, because that, as far as I know, was typically on PlayStation. So if they keep getting dibs on that, that's a pretty big deal for them, especially if it's exclusive to the Switch and it's not coming to PS4 or anything like that. That's cool.
Yeah. If it's a game that I can play without much prior knowledge, and if it comes out in a time where there's not a whole lot else that I want to play, I might pick it up. Because I've never played a Shin Megami Tensei game, but everyone tells me that they're, like, amazing and really, really well put together games.
Mm.
And I enjoyed FE Shop, so if I'm assuming it's not very similar in terms of, like, tone and stuff, because that was about pop idols and whatever, but if the, like,
Yeah, I don't think
if
so.
If the, If the dungeons are anything to go by, I really enjoyed what I played of FE Shop, so maybe. I don't know. Then the next game was Project Octopath Traveler, which was
really
the weird, like,
the
2.5D, I don't know.
It was like a 3D world, 2D pixel art people, and
yeah, it's this weird.
Good.
It's a weird sort of combination that I'm interested.
It's the Bravely team, isn't it?
Yes.
I think.
Yes, pretty sure. Game looks neat. I hope they get an official title soon, though.
Project Octopath Traveler is the official title for
No!
I mean, they could just call it Octopath Traveler.
No matter
just
what.
The project. No, do you
what
not remember Project Hammer? Didn't Project Hammer come out eventually?
What the fuck is that name?
Project Hammer.
Octopath
on the Wii.
Traveler.
Eight Paths Traveler. Maybe there's eight paths.
Probably. It's probably
no.
the...
Project Hammer got shut down.
Oh. Rip. So, yeah.
When we know more about it, I'll...
Yeah, it looks interesting, but I don't know anything about it, really.
No, it looks like an RPG.
Yeah.
So.
And it's something that I think that's exciting about the Switch is that we're gonna get a lot of that, like we saw on the 3DS, like a lot of really good Japanese games,
mm-hmm.
and that's kind of the beginning of it. I mean, like the 3DS is a gold mine for JRPGs and cool Japanese games. So I'm expecting the Switch to carry that torch. So seeing that already start to come to fruition is pretty neat.
Not that it was mentioned in the presentation, but probably the key example that I can think of that is Fire Emblem for the Switch 2018.
Yes! My god. Like, can we just talk about Fire Emblem for a second? Because that Fire Emblem Direct was like, oh, you like Fire Emblem? You can have four games. We don't mind.
Yeah. Like,
okay.
I think everyone was just
expecting... We've got Fire Emblem Heroes, we've got Fire Emblem Echoes, we've got Fire Emblem Warriors, and then we've got Fire Emblem for the Switch. And yeah. I'm like, this was a franchise that almost stopped existing in 2012.
Yeah. I think
that's just amazing.
The key to everything is waifus.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. We'll see how Echoes does, because it doesn't look like it's got the waifus.
And good gameplay, but waifus... Yeah.
Unless the sister is a waifu.
Maybe she is a waifu, I don't know. Well, it probably still has waifus, you just can't make them your official waifu.
Yeah.
The amount of times we have said waifu in the last 40 seconds.
You know? Do you know the real reason for why I want to restart Birthright, following on from last episode?
Because you want to marry Anna.
Yeah, because I made the mistake of being like, the story probably wants me to marry Shizune, or whatever her name is. Shizune's her son, isn't it?
Azura. Shigure is her son, yeah.
Is because a mission later after I married her, I met Anna, and I'm like, no! And she was my wife
Anna
in Awakening.
Anna was who you married in Awakening.
Yeah, so...
That's the closest Kinross has to waifus, I guess.
Yeah, she loves money.
She would sell me if she had to. Or if she could make a profit.
Yeah.
So after that, they brought out Sega on stage, and Sega were like, we're going to develop some games, and we were like, okay.
All the best thing about that was all the people who grew up in the Nintendo versus Sega era, drew comparisons to Game of Thrones, like Nintendo were the Ramsay Bolton and Sega were Reek. And they were just dragging him out to be like, we're making games for you, master. Say it.
They did sort of announce, I don't think they announced it at the presentation, but they did sort of announce Puyo Puyo Tetris.
Mm-hmm.
And I really like Puyo Puyo Pop, and I like Tetris, so I'm probably going to get it.
Never played Puyo Puyo Pop, but the little bit that I saw, I will probably pick up.
Puyo Puyo Tetris, as far as I know, is not a full price game.
I will take it. It's on AmiAmi right now, so I can check the Japanese yen price. It's 4,800 yen.
Yeah, that's
probably
nothing.
About 30 quid. About $48.
It's 30 quid. $40.
Yeah, I'll probably pick up Puyo Puyo Tetris. I've got to be honest.
Yeah, it looks like a good little multiplayer game as well.
It looks fun.
Four player multiplayer local.
And then, what else was it? EA came out on stage to be like, we're making FIFA.
Did they announce Sonic on stage or no?
No, they didn't. No, I didn't even know that. Oh, Sonic Mania.
Yeah.
No.
No, okay.
Sonic Mania is coming out as well, but that's coming out on everything, so. Mm-hmm. Also, it's Puyo Puyo Tetris, I guess. Well, it's coming out on PlayStation?
Yes. Yeah. PS4.
Puyo Puyo Tetris Spring, by the way.
Oh, okay.
This is dawned on me.
Sonic Mania.
This is like a quick aside. I just thought of this. You know, it'd be an amazing port for the Switch to have, because I love this game and I think it'd be
Katamari.
Awesome. Katamari. Besides Katamari, Overcooked, I think would be a really awesome.
Oh, yes.
Could you imagine taking that anywhere and then ripping off the two Joy-Cons and playing Overcooked with somebody, like wherever the hell you want? Like,
that would be amazing.
That would be great.
Yes.
That would be fun.
I wouldn't be surprised if that's there, if he's working on that, or whoever the hell made that game. I don't know. If
Team 17,
isn't
it? Or are they just the publishers?
I would not be surprised.
Tweet them. I subtweeted them about Ukulele and they replied to me, so.
FIFA, hooray.
FIFA.
That's a big deal in terms of grabbing a market share, because if you can convince people to buy a FIFA game that they can play on the go, they will buy that unit.
Yeah.
That's true.
So if
that's very true.
Only if it's a mainline FIFA game, if it's like one of the spin-off offcasts that came out for the Wii and the Wii U, it probably won't do as much good. But if it's legitimately like FIFA 18, I guess it'll be, that'll shift consoles.
Yeah. I don't really care about FIFA personally, but no. There's a market for it, and it's
a huge
massive market.
Yeah.
Like, I think they only just stopped in the last, like, 2 years developing it for the PS2. So.
Yeah. So, that's a big deal, yeah. if it's a proper FIFA.
And then, there was Suda, who came out on stage.
Poor guy. Probably got fired. We don't know. But Nintendo were posting for a new translator.
So, Suda came out on stage. And immediately I was like, what's happening? Because, like, nothing was happening. And then I noticed the t-shirt he was wearing was the Santa Destroy logo. And I was like, huh? Don't you be teasing me, Suda. Don't you do this to me. And then he said that he is working on a new game that includes Travis Touchdown, but he did not announce No More Heroes 3.
Yeah.
If it's not No More Heroes 3, I'm gonna eat a whole cake until I make myself ill. Because it has to be No More Heroes 3, because he's been hinting at it for so long that it's a project that he wants to make. And I think No More Heroes and Killer 7 are probably, like, his two biggest things that he's done. Mm. Maybe Lollipop Chainsaw as well, actually.
Yeah. Can I just read what he said?
Yeah.
So, if you didn't watch the presentation, literally for half of the time that Suda was on stage, the translator was silent. We were like, what the hell? And then he's like, Santa Travis Touchdown! It was pretty brutal. And a YouTube commenter went through and translated what Suda said. And this is... It's a bit long, but I'll go through. Yeah! Guess that bombed. Suda from Grasshopper here. Hello, everyone. Today is the big January 13th Ariake Showdown. I've been invited to this special match, not an exhibition. I'm up here for a round on the stage to talk about my game. Hang on, let me check the teleprompter. Does everyone remember the man from Santa Destroy that Grasshopper and Marvelous created in their tag team game? Right, Travis Touchdown. Switch! Show the image, please. There it is! This legendary anti-hero will be touching back down on the Nintendo Switch. We're not announcing the title just yet, and not to change the subject, but... So last year, all throughout the year, I was at events like PAX and Kyoto's Bit Summit. I went to all kinds of gaming events like those. I talked to a lot of indie devs there about all kinds of things, and they were like, Suda, man, what's the Switch like? Well, back then, I think people were still calling it the NX. I tell them, no, I have no idea. I know as much as you guys. And they'd all be like, come on, tell us. Is it as easy to develop for as everyone's saying? I had to tell them, just wait. I'm under NDA with Nintendo. I can't tell you anything. There were lots of stuff, little scuffles like that. But indie devs all over the world were excited for the Switch, even the ones in Japan. The dev environment is probably as good as everyone's hoping for. It's really good for... Well, I get the feeling the Switch can even connect indies and major titles, so I'm going to try making a game that'll become the singularity between indies and the Nintendo Switch, and it'll be centered around Travis. Travis co-starring with an indie star. Well, to put it in simpler terms, in wrestling it'd be like shoot style versus hardcore wrestling. Well, maybe not quite. Well, like in Fire Pro Wrestling, Saber with Kitta. Basically, I can't really explain it that well, but yeah, Travis is going to bust his way onto Nintendo Switch. Suda51 from Grasshopper out. Thank you.
Yeah! Beautiful.
Suda. That poor translator. What?
I kind of wonder if it'll be a bit like, in No More Heroes 2, there was sort of like a boss versus mode,
mm-hmm.
where you could just like fight bosses. I wonder if it'll be like a wrestling game between two characters from No More Heroes.
Maybe.
And I'm going to be really fucking sad if that's the case. I'll buy it regardless, because if they want numbers, I'll give them another number. Like,
yeah.
I just loved No More Heroes. And I don't think, like I said, I was watching the reaction from the Nintendo World Store in New York. And I don't think I realized until that point just how many people really, really liked No More Heroes. Mm. Because people were, like, really genuinely quite excited to see Travis return in some sort of form. And I'm excited because Travis is great. He's an otaku who likes wrestling and watches a lot of porn, so... Mm.
That part I'm not so keen on, but to each their own.
I would love it if it was No More Heroes 3. I would absolutely love it if it was No More Heroes 3.
It sounds like it's going to be a team-up of some kind. Unless that's another translation quirk of it's like, it's not actually a crossover, but I don't know. That was such
a guess I just got to wait and see.
Yeah.
Like, just got to wait until Suda is good and ready to...
And can read a teleprompter.
Let me check the teleprompter. I'm going to talk about indie games now.
Yeah.
All right. Well, moving on from that, that was pretty much the end of it as far as I remember.
What about...
from one big thing.
Two... Well, another thing. They announced Elder Scrolls Skyrim for the Switch.
Oh, yeah, of course.
They actually announced it.
Someone said on Twitter, Todd Howard looks like he's trapped in the opening for Phantom Blood from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure.
Yeah, I can see that.
Oh, it was such a good tweet.
Yeah, so...
I was very excited to see Todd Howard there. Very excited about Skyrim. However, I don't know if I need to buy a third copy of the game when I've already spent about 700 hours playing Skyrim in total, so...
I would put it in the category of buy it so that third parties see that this stuff sells.
Yeah, but £60.
Yeah. Maybe buy it when it's a bit cheaper.
Oh, yeah. Hold on. For those of you who are wondering what £60 is in
Abby's taken
US
my job.
Dollars,
I feel so bad.
It's $74.28.
Yeah.
Would you pay $75 for Skyrim on Switch?
Potentially not the special edition version.
I wouldn't pay that for any game ever.
But you can take it on the go with you.
What about Shenmue 3? It's the only version that'll come out. It costs $75. Do you buy it?
Yeah.
Mass Effect Andromeda, $75. Do you buy it?
It's the only version. Yeah, but that's not the only Skyrim version though. So
no, that's true.
But you got me there with my logic. I wouldn't buy any game for $75. I mean, like, I guess it's circumstance. Yeah, Skyrim.
Would you buy Elder Scrolls 6 for $75?
Yeah.
So if this was a new game, you'd buy it.
It'd be one of those things where, like, I don't want to set a precedent or anything. Like,
yeah.
But everyone else is going to buy it. So, like, no one's going to set a precedent. Like, no one's going to make a stand.
It's the most awkward thing because you don't want to set the precedent, but you really, really want to support them.
Yeah.
After what happened to the Wii U, I'm like, I need to support third parties as much as I physically can.
I mean, the Skyrim remaster on PS4 and... Xbone were both released at $60. Oh, yeah. Not $75, but they both released as full-priced games, which I think was a little much anyway. I think the remaster on PS4 and Xbone should have launched at $40. People bought this game 80,000 times already. Some extra flowers don't do anything that's worth it. Another full $60 purchase. Granted, it went on sale not long after here. You could pretty much throughout all of December and all of this month, you could find it at U.S. retail was for $40 or under on sale, but... shouldn't have launched at $60. Just like the Switch version shouldn't be that price at all.
I can play Skyrim in a car now without spending like thousands of dollars on a laptop.
Yep.
There we go.
So there is that.
That
and
is
I do
exciting.
Like Skyrim.
That is really
I do
exciting.
Like Skyrim. And then the other one, the last one, last game that they announced at this conference.
Snipperclips.
There is
Lego there, City Undercover. No, didn't they announce the Shovel Knight trilogy? No, that was on Twitter. Sorry, my bad.
No, that was on Twitter.
They're ace in the hole to sell
Minecraft
this puppy.
Story mode, the complete adventure.
Yeah.
Zelda.
Oh yeah, Zelda.
Zelda no Densetsu.
Now we were. For context, this aired at 4 a.m. for us.
On my birthday.
On Abby's
my
birthday. She very kindly woke up at 3:30 so that she could watch this. And so we were a bit tired and they were very clearly wrapping up and it suddenly dawned on us, we've not heard about Zelda yet. Are they really not going to talk about Zelda? Because over here at least there's been a lot of rumours that the US and Japan would get it on launch day. But that we wouldn't get it until early June, potentially, because of translations and whatnot. And at that point, it hadn't been confirmed that the Switch was region-free. So we were very much concerned that we were going to have to import from America just to play the bloody game. And then, like, they're not going to talk about it, no. And switching to Reggie, and Reggie's doing his signing off thing after the Mr. Shibata had done it. That was terrifying. And then he passes over to Mr. Miyamoto, and it was amazing. And Zelda, I love it. I want it.
So I had a really big suspicion that Zelda was going to be a launch title from the rest of the conference and them not saying what their big launch title
I guess.
Was. So I was like, it's got to be Zelda. Like, there's no way it's not Zelda, because they don't have anything else that they can offer as a launch title that's going to excite people. Because Mario's coming out in the holiday. Remember that one time that Luigi had a game instead of Mario, and the GameCube did not do well. So it had to be Zelda, like 100% for me. Mm-hmm. As it went on, it was dawning on me that it had to be Zelda, and it was.
Yeah.
Coming out on March 3rd. Super excited! I can't wait. 40 days. Ah.
More voice acting than just Zelda. Quite a few characters. At least four. Zelda,
Deku, Zelda, Impa, maybe
Impa person, and potentially the king.
Yes.
So four. It's a big deal.
Voice acting.
Very big
Hopefully
deal.
Hopefully it doesn't turn out like the Zelda CDI games.
Yeah.
You've killed me!
It has.
Good!
It's going to be that typical argument of weebs, of sub versus dub.
There are some
voices I prefer.
Thing again.
Well, this is the problem.
For you, it's the problem. For me, it's not the problem.
Oh, did you not see what I said?
Wait, what? No.
There is no dual audio.
No!
Yeah. Inuma said that the only way that you could have dual audio would be if you changed your system settings to Japanese, but then the text would be in Japanese.
For fuck's sake.
Yeah.
Aonuma!
Yeah.
Fix me!
Which is unfortunate, because there are some voices I quite liked in the Japanese, in the English dub. I quite liked the Deku voice.
I thought the whole trailer was better in Japanese, personally.
My biggest problem with the English, one, the English cry by Zelda is pathetic.
Oh, God, it's the worst.
But they open with who we're calling Impa, the old lady, who just sounds like a young person talking like this. Let me tell you the story of Ganon and the royal family of Hyrule. It just sounds like a young person doing a voice. It's awful. And that bums me out. So I need to learn to read Japanese.
Get on it, man.
You got 40 days.
Yeah.
Or hopefully they can patch it. I don't know. Someone's bound to work around it. Because if he's saying that you can change the system settings, then clearly the audio is on the cart. Right?
You think so?
Yeah. You'd imagine.
So I don't know. Maybe that's something they could patch, but it bums me out. I don't like to be that sub versus dub guy. The dub's pretty good, aside from Zelda and Impa.
Can we talk about how badass Zelda looks, though? Like, in general. She looks so cool. She's wearing trousers.
She doesn't look anything like a princess.
That's why I like her. Mm. She's cool. And the fact that she's got an amiibo makes me think that she's going to do more in the game other than sit in Hyrule Castle. Which...
I mean, you can clearly tell that she sits naked in a well.
Yep.
Or a spring, even. And she cries. She's supposed to be a strong, independent woman. She's breaking down in tears. What is this?
She's human.
No. Well, I mean, she's not.
She's Hylian.
Yeah. She has emotions. Get over it.
The game looks phenomenal. Everything I've seen of Breath of the Wild is impressive.
Abby, I think the only thing Abby's not seen is the second trailer.
I cannot wait to play it. I can't wait to play it. I've been avoiding as much as I could about it because I don't want to know. Like, we watched the E3 stuff.
Blackout. Good idea.
So
we watched the E3 stuff, and I'm like, cool. I know I'm going to like this game. I don't want to watch anymore. I don't want to hear anything else about it as much as I can possibly avoid it until I get my hands on the game.
Mm-hmm. And I guess you saw the E3 stuff, the Game Awards stuff, and then the stuff at the conference, right?
Yeah. That's all I've seen of it so far.
So I also saw the second trailer, and I've watched about 10 hours of the game.
I just want it. I want it so bad.
The fact that I want it after seeing 10 hours of the bloody plateau is it speaks volumes to me.
Although I'm gonna be that person that's like, oh yeah, I've not touched the story in like 72 hours.
Yeah,
like, it's been a while.
And even after seeing the moment of coming out of that cave at least 50 times through trailers and people playing it, I am willing to bet I will be blown away watching that cutscene in person.
I can't wait. Bill, what do I do? I can't wait.
This game.
I just love it. I love it already, and I feel like...
We're getting screwed over on the special edition, though. I'm just going to say that. Screw you.
Yeah, that's
what true. What do we get?
So, Americans get the game, the CD... Oh, you've got two versions. You've got the Master Edition and the Special Edition. So the Master Edition comes with the game, a soundtrack, a map, a commemorative coin, a carry case, and a statue of the Master Sword. The Special Edition comes with everything except for the Master Sword. Over here, we get the game, soundtrack, and the Master Sword.
Although I imagine all of the Master Edition copies in the US have sold out by now. So.
Probably. But I wanted the carry case and the map and coin.
I really wanted the carry case because it was the Sheikah Slate. And it was cool.
Yeah. But c'est la vie. I'm just... really, the only thing that I super wanted is the soundtrack. So I'm glad that we get that. But,
was their conference...
Yes.
I mean, we didn't talk anything about the actual console itself with the HD Rumble and the touchscreen.
Yeah, yeah.
I feel like HD Rumble is one of those things that I can't talk about properly until
you've not
tried
used it.
But,
yeah, I've heard
there's a lot of tech packed into this thing.
I've heard it feels interesting, the HD Rumble, from people who got hands on at the New York event and everything. I hear it's like it's something that just feels weird. Like you could really feel it. Like when he's talking about the ice cubes and shit on stage, like that shit's legit.
Comes in 2.5 colors.
Yeah,
gray or neon blue and red. Which is an interesting choice.
I ordered the neon blue and red, if you are curious, because I did pre-order a Switch.
Yep, as did I.
Now, overall, I wasn't too happy with it. The conference.
Oh no!
So, what was your issue? I can either see that your issue was that 1-2 Switch wasn't a bundle game, which we've already talked about, and you weren't too keen on the launch lineup.
I think it was accentuated even more during the end when they did the Zelda thing. I think like present day Nintendo is so much better at Directs, granted, this is all under new leadership as well. Like a lot of those guys on stage are faces that we'll be getting used to seeing a little more. But like I think like if they did this as a direct and delivered it in a more
Nintendo way,
yeah, I think a lot of it would have been easier to take. But I think there was a lot of awkwardness with the translation and a lot of. And I appreciated the quirkiness of the live presentation, like the live conference with the whole, like, let's switch. And like, they would go to another guy or whatever.
Yeah.
I always got a good chuckle out of that. And I thought like, you know, like maybe it wasn't executed perfectly, but it was endearing enough to where it's like, this is fun.
I really liked that even though it was a more traditional conference of, standard E3, I like that they got these people who were like the lead directors of the games that they were talking about, who people have never seen before, to do the talking rather than like Reggie or
just
Bill
Reggie,
or whatever.
Yeah,
it was just
out,
it was
yeah.
people who were clearly like in the trenches, working on this thing, talking about this new hardware, and it felt more, more believable, more authentic, because it was clearly PR fluff, but because it wasn't coming from someone that you know. Is in that role like Reggie or Shigzy, it felt more believable and authentic.
Yeah.
So I appreciated that. They could have done that in a direct for sure, but I approved that they went that
way. I just think the way that the information was presented, I think if they really hammered it out, because there was a few stuff missing from this that I think like they kind of needed to have in there, in my opinion. Like, I think they needed to come out and explain the online system and the way it works, and they didn't do that.
Yeah.
Like they kind of shuffled you away to a website that still doesn't really have that much information. Like, it's very similar to what Sony did with like they just shoved there, you got to pay for Plus announcement in the bottom in fine print, like, and everyone like saw it and went, wait a second, what does that say down there? Like, and then like they really gave no other information on what Plus would exactly be until later. But like, I think that's kind of important, especially on a stage where you're announcing like Splatoon 2 and ARMS and like games that are gonna presumably be like, you know, bigger mainstays. For the online system, especially if you're getting rid of Miiverse and stuff. And like, I was really interested to see like how they would take the online infrastructure, because that's something like I'm really rooting for them to like do really well. I don't need my like online thing to be like incredible, but like, you know, there's no denying the way they've handled the way they've handled friends lists and everything in the past has always just been so like, Nintendo, come on. So like, I was really rooting for them to like come out and like, because that's always a big question mark, you know, like with this, and it's always been a conversation between people like on the side of like, our friend code's gone, our Mii's gone, is you know, Miiverse, blah blah blah. Like, you know, how are we going to connect with people on this console or whatever handheld, whatever the hell it is exactly. I consider it a console first and foremost still, but and they kind of didn't, and like, I was kind of bummed out about that. I don't mind having to pay for this online service, like, as long as it's good, you know. And I like the idea of the free NES/SNES game every month. Granted, it's timed, whatever, you know.
Who's gonna play an NES or SNES game for more than a month?
I'm sure what they have planned around those offers when they mention like it's. All of them are going to have, like, what, unique online features and stuff? Yeah. I'm sure there will be something community-based around those games for that month.
You know what? I also assume that if you are paying your monthly thing, then you get a discount on the eShop if you want to buy it. That would be the most obvious thing. If you don't get to keep it for free, you get a discount on it.
Yeah, that would be cool. That would be cool. And it's information I kind of wish they had. Like I looked at before this conference, and like a lot of it can maybe be blamed on expectation, but I think there were expectations set, I think, by the excitement drummed up around their initial reveal video back in October.
Yeah.
And like all of the rumors surrounding it and all of this stuff, you know, like everyone was like really feeling it. And when they, sorry to drop Xenoblade stuff in there.
Let's not lose our heads though.
But. But everybody was really feeling it around that Switch reveal back in October. Like, that video was great. It was to the point. It was really well done. And then all the rumors rousing up around it. Oh, shit. Where was I going with that?
Don't know.
Expectations.
You were talking about online.
The online. Blah, 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 blah. Yeah, I don't know. So I'll just move on to my next thing. Mm-hmm. Is like around when that video came out, you know, like I really want Nintendo to like come out on stage and like just fuck everyone up. Like I want it to happen so bad. I wanted the initial Switch reveal to be on stage at E3, and I wanted them to come out and like have a lineup of games that just punched everyone in the fucking ass. Mm-hmm. Like, really bad, because, like, everyone talks shit on Nintendo, you know, and...
They still do.
Like, and they still do, and, like...
One of the things that I've noticed in, like, my Twitter timeline is a lot of people going, why have you pre-ordered a Switch? Like, whoever pre-ordered a Switch, why have you done it? And it's like, because I love Nintendo games, and I know that it's a worthwhile investment for me. Sure, the accessories are expensive, and there's, like, the grip that it comes with doesn't charge the Joy-Cons and all that sort of stuff. But... Overall, I've never had a Nintendo console and been like, man, that was a waste of money. Like, no. I have faith in this company that I have loved since I was a kid, so they can have my pre-order money.
And that's totally fair. I think that's a thing a lot of people forget. And like, even like people who were disappointed in the conference, like me, I feel like a lot of them don't really realize like how people feel about Nintendo. Everyone just looks at it and goes like, ugh, like. Just because it's not worth it for one person doesn't mean it can't be worth it for other people. And there's totally valid reasons to pre-order the Switch and get it on launch day. Like, especially like for you guys who are like massive Zelda fans, like that's like the reason. Like, Nintendo did a really great job making sure that was a launch title. Like, that secures sales for sure. I mean, like, I don't think I'll I can sit here and talk shit on the launch lineup all I want, like, but there's no denying that they're launching with, like, a better game than most consoles launch with, typically. You know, like not a lot of consoles typically launch with a flagship franchise like that, especially one that's looking as impressive as this. And,
it's like if the PS4 launched with Uncharted 4.
Yeah. And it's, now, like, for me personally, like, I was expecting a little more out of the conference, like, more information on the online. I was expecting a little more, at launch. Like, all it would take for me personally is if Mario Kart launched with it. And it's not coming out that long from
after,
it.
No.
But it's almost 2 months because it's coming out at the end of April.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if they had Mario Kart 8 Deluxe and Zelda on launch, I very likely would be in, just because I love Mario Kart 8. That was my game of the year. That game is so perfect, and the fact that I can play Inklings in it, like, I'm in. Like, you know, like, that's for sure. Like, I'm totally in on that. And the new battle modes and all that stuff. Like,
or you know, mean old battle mode?
Yeah.
Right. New old battle mode.
Like, that's exciting.
Yeah. I feel like there are two or three groups of people who are, well, four groups of how they see this conference. They loved it, like Abby and I. They just, everything about it, well, most things about it, they loved. The people who were determined to hate it because it's Nintendo, and so they're going to crap on everything anyway. Mm-hmm. And the people who were intrigued, such as yourself, who are still intrigued but are feeling disappointed by the vagueness that was still present. So rather than Ebby and I being like, look at all this great stuff, you're coming from the perspective of, there's this stuff that they really didn't address that I wish that they had, which is totally fair.
Yeah, I didn't want to be like a downer.
I would have been disappointed if you were one of those people. I know you're not anti-Nintendo,
I'm still excited
anything
for
that you
it.
Say,
yeah.
I would be like, I do understand that, but Zelda.
Yeah, that's the
all
thing.
These
yeah,
things I, that I love. Are
I was live chatting with my friends during the conference, and like they both have theirs pre-ordered and everything, and they're like, they're Zelda fans, like huge Zelda fans, and like after the conference ended, they were like, oh my god, like I'm pre-ordering right now, like I need to get on there, and like, Billy, what'd you think? And I'm like, oh fuck, like I don't want to have to do this, like I like was kind of deflated. Now it's really hard to be deflated after watching that Zelda trailer, because one of the best trailers I've ever seen, period. Like, out of all games, I thought it was really well done. Like, the music and the way everything like just comes together in that trailer, like it's emotionally well done. But besides that, like I was like, man, I don't know how to like formulate this into a message without sounding like an ass.
Yeah.
Like, and like without sounding like one of those dicks on the internet who was like so happy that maybe it wasn't the best conference ever. Like, 'cause there's a lot of people on the internet who are super happy that Nintendo like didn't like come out and be like, yo, we got Metroid and we got
that. They didn't do literally everything that anyone ever wanted.
Like they didn't come out and basically do like the Shenmue 3 Final Fantasy 7 Remake Last Guardian thing, where it's like, what the fuck? Like, no one's ever doing that. Like that
the fact
never
that
happens.
Sony did it was ridiculous.
Yeah, like that just doesn't happen, you know? Like, be realistic and you will be fine in life. So, like, I was mostly, like, I want to buy this thing on launch was my mindset going into the conference. Like, I'm super excited for the Switch. I'm so glad we're going to see a deeper dive on it. I think the tech involved is awesome. I still have the idea of the console. I'm still buying one. I'm buying one when Splatoon 2 comes out. That's my launch day.
Okay.
For the Switch. I'm buying it in the summer 100%. I will walk into the store and walk out of it with the Switch and Splatoon, hopefully, depending on stock.
Honestly, makes me really happy, because I bought the Wii U on launch and I had no one to play with for so long, and the fact that already two people I know are going to get one within the first few months is just like, yes.
I'm not missing Splatoon.
I think Andy could be convinced when Splatoon comes out.
Yeah, he probably
as well.
Will.
But, like, I don't see how I could ever resist that. Like, when I start seeing, like, the marketing for the game ramp up whenever they get a release date, like, how they did those cool videos and stuff, like, like with First Splatoon, and, like, just hearing the music instantly in that conference, I was, like, so hyped. Like that, I love Splatoon, so I'm in, that's my, if they would have launched with Splatoon 2, it's
that
really,
would have been ridiculous.
It's really what they launched with, right? Like, so, like, yeah, like they're launching with Zelda. I'm like, I like Zelda. Like, I don't hate Zelda. I always appreciate it, and I like playing them. The music's fantastic. They do really great things with dungeon design, and I love Hyrule Warriors. But I'm not like a $360 on launch day Zelda fan, like to where like I would go buy a new console and the game just to play Zelda, because there's nothing else I'd really want to play on launch. Like the thing is when I say talk about the launch lineup, I'm sure those games aren't bad at all. It's just I don't want to play any of them right now. You know,
I mean, so, this is the other thing. A lot of people go launch day lineup, which for reference is Zelda, 1-2 Switch, Just Dance, Skylanders, Bomberman R, and I think Binding of Isaac got confirmed as a launch title.
Yeah, it did.
And then there are, which is 6 games, not great for launch day. And then there's people like myself who are thinking, the Wii U had like 8 months where nothing came out. With this, it's like there's a fairly big game coming out every month up until Christmas. I prefer the slow burn of just every month Nintendo will get 60 of my pounds.
As much as I was kind of deflated after the conference, and like, you know, like my initial reaction to it was kind of like, man, like I really wish the controllers weren't $70. I really wish the online was more in detail, and I kind of wish the launch lineup was a little bit different. But I think, like you said, one thing that I've sat and like thought about, at, you know, as I've talked about it with friends or read about it online, or like what they have lined up for the first year of Switch, like from launch until the end of the year, like is like really like big. Like they have Zelda, they have a Mario Kart game, they have Splatoon, they have Mario. Like that's nuts. Like planned out for the rest of the year, and like you said, like there were always droughts on the Wii U, especially around launch when, you know, waiting for Nintendo's first parties to like pick up the slack a little bit. But like they kind of have that slack already picked up a bit, and like they have their launch year, like this entire year, kind of mapped out of like we have big franchises coming at all sections of the year. You know, on launch you're getting our big open world Zelda game, which should keep you busy for a while, and like it's kind of appreciative that they launch with a big game like that. Because then you don't need to go out and spend like $150 on these like other little games that are out on launch, you know, like money's tight or whatever for a lot of people. So like, you know, going out and buying a brand new console and getting and like five usually games. It's like, yeah, usually it's like, whoa, what game should I get on launch? You know, like, should I get the Call of Duty game? Should I get whatever? Like, oh, I don't know. Like, I mean, you buy it and it's like it's never really that good, whatever. It's, you know, but like you're getting Zelda on launch, and like there's really no better seal of quality than that logo on a box, you know. So it's like. No. That's a pretty big deal.
For what it's worth,
Sorry,
there are 27 games announced for 2017 so far. That's a lot of games.
And
they're announcing more like every week.
That's the other thing that like I have to remember, and like other people have to remember, is the way Nintendo operates is so much different than the way like Sony or Microsoft will handle their press. Typically, and like I think a lot of people were maybe expecting that. I think for not me personally, but I think some people were disappointed because they were expecting Nintendo to come out and be like, "Yo, look at this! We've got Mass Effect. We've got Red Dead." Like, I don't think those games will come over to the Switch, and that's perfectly fine. I think a lot of people were expecting that, like the Nintendo to kind of join Microsoft and Sony in like that thing. But like they're still Nintendo, and they're still gonna do their thing. But they operate differently in the way that they announce like stuff with directs, like out of nowhere. Like, we have 4 new Fire Emblem games. Like it's out of
they could
time
easily
and space.
Have done that in the bloody
thing.
But no, they're like, we're gonna show up a little bit of this one game.
Yeah,
and then you watch the Treehouse, and they're like, so they talked about Fire Emblem Warriors. There's gonna be a direct next Tuesday. And like, they announce 4 games. It's like, what?
Like, they could easily, like, in like a month, come out and go, oh, there's an Animal Crossing Direct on, like, February 20th. And then go ahead and announce Animal Crossing Switch, the mobile game that's also coming out, and something else. Like, this out of nowhere. They'll just be like, eh, let's do it. Like, they operate in a different way than the other companies do. And, like, I still appreciate that.
I call it that they work more on a social network level than Microsoft and Sony do, Sony has 2 events, doesn't they? They've got E3, and then they've got PSX or whatever it's called.
PSX, yeah. PSX
and,
is really
and Microsoft
cool.
Just has E3, whereas Nintendo is just, they send out a tweet being like, we've got this thing coming in next Friday at 2 PM Eastern, and everyone knows about it. And they announce 6 games or whatever.
I still think I still think, like, I'm not expecting the Switch to be... I'm expecting it to get a lot of third-party support, but I'm not expecting it to maybe get the kind that is necessarily like, oh, it's going to get a Battlefield, it's going to get whatever. Like, I don't think it's going to get stuff like that. I think people are going to develop for it. Like, it's evident by their support, and it's evident by what Suda says about how easy it is to develop for, and it's evident by EA stepping up and all that stuff. But I'm still kind of excited for it because it is still a Nintendo console, and I did like the Wii U. And all they have to do is do things a little smarter about how they launch their games on a schedule, and they've already kind of addressed that with the way this year looks. So as much as I'm not getting one on launch due to what's out on launch, for me personally, obviously it's a megaton for Zelda fans, but for me personally, that and there's just too much coming out for me on other stuff over the next 2 months that I just, if I didn't have Neo, Yakuza, Horizon, For Honor, Gravity Rush 2 coming out all Resi. Within the next, yeah, all within the next month, then like that money would probably be Switch money, you know? Yeah. So it, it's a testament also to how crazy this year is with games and hardware releases. But I really wanted to to want it at launch. I really wanted to, and I'm still buying one. I'm still excited.
You're in a better position than Abby and I because you get to save till summer.
Yeah, I was saying it to my friend the other day.
I've got spreadsheets telling me how much money I need to save each week.
Like, I'm kind of thankful in a way that like I don't have like a personal compelling reason to buy it on launch. Like I told him, I go, if Splatoon 2 was a launch title for some reason, I would be in the worst spot ever because I'd be sitting here trying to figure out how I'm going to pull it off because I would not miss, I'm not missing Splatoon launch. Like, it's just not happening. Like, I'm in there on day one. I'm not missing whatever that new city is. Like, I'm getting in there. I'm seeing Callie and Marie the first damn day. And I'm not, did they die in the last Splatfest?
Well, no, the story thing had Marie turned away wearing a coat, looking all sad, and we're like,
what happened to Callie?
It's going to be an expensive year.
It's going to be, because like, my Switch purchase is still in there. It's still nestled into this year somewhere, and...
There's like 50 games total announced for this thing already, and admittedly, at least 25% of them I have zero interest in whatsoever, but then the others are like, I might check that out.
Is there an Ethernet port on the dock?
Nope.
No. But they will sell, apparently, Hori are apparently going to make a USB adapter for Ethernet.
Okay.
Like the Wii and the Wii U had.
I wish I could ask someone. It's not that big a deal to me, but like I kind of wish I could like walk in there and be like, "Why haven't you guys put one on your consoles yet?" Like,
No like, power brick.
I already own it. I already own a USB Ethernet, so like I bought one for the Wii U, so like that should work. You never hopefully. Know. Hopefully, but I just want like, why don't you guys do that? Like, why? I mean, granted. Depending on what they've got receiving the Wi-Fi, I know they improved the Wi-Fi reception on the PS4 Pro by a good bit. So, it's not like Wi-Fi is terrible or anything like that. But no. I just like my video games hardwired. I didn't hate it. That's my review.
Okay.
The Switch conference.
That's a pretty good review.
I didn't hate it.
I was worried going into this, cause like I didn't want to be a downer. Like I said earlier, I'm like, I know Kinross and Abby really like the conference, and they have every reason to do so. Like there's no invalid reason to like, this thing. Like, at all. Like a lot of people will try to say you shan't like this. Nintendo did not learn from the Wii U. There is no possible reason to own a Switch. Well, their entire launch stock sold out. So, I mean, there must be some reasons, you know.
I saw a video, like, I respect Jim Sterling as a person, but the immediate video that he released, like, Jimquisition-wise, announced was how Nintendo fucked up already, and I'm like, I'm not gonna watch it. Yeah. I'm just not gonna watch it because I can't. I don't want to surround myself with negativity, so, like, in regards to the Switch. And that's a very, very strong title.
I think it's a really a matter of people need to look at Nintendo and, like, learn what to expect from them at this point. Like, they're doing what they've been doing, kind of, and, like, if it's working for them, and if they think that the Switch can be more successful than the Wii U, just based off marketing and, like, obviously early indicators is that it will be more successful than the Wii U, especially because this is presumably... they'll say it'll coexist with the 3DS for a little while, but they said that about the other handhelds as well. Whenever the DS came out, oh, the Game Boy isn't going away. It's like, okay, I mean, you could say that, but, like, the Switch will presumably become the thing that games are on, you know? And like that is their Nintendo platform, which is super exciting... Because that means the people making games for the 3DS and all of that can move over to Switch development, which increases the library by a fuckload, because the 3DS had an amazing library.
I don't know, because it sounds like, from what Reggie was saying, that they still want to actively develop for the 3DS because they're two different markets.
Because, I mean, that's the 3DS over is cheaper time, and...
I think that the two market... I think that their goal is, yes, these are two separate markets, but in... 2 or 3 years that they'll be much more unified markets that they will then be able to just go, okay, we're now developing solely for the Switch.
I mean, I feel that mostly because, like, at some point they're going to want you to be carrying your Switch around and not your 3DS as well.
Well, give me Street Pass on my Switch then. I'll be
happy. That's another thing I'm kind of, I mean, like I really loved, like, some of the little things Nintendo had on the Wii U and the 3DS, like, social-wise. And I think, like, if they brought some of that over to the Switch's online and expanded on it instead of getting rid of it and saying, oh, here's a new thing and you got to pay for it, but we don't have any details on it yet. It's like, man, like, maybe saying, oh, it's the Miiverse, but it's expanded, and, like, you could do this and this and this, and it's got Street Pass and all that. Like, these are all things you've already made. Like I love that stuff. I loved it.
Sorry. Did we want to talk about the app?
We can talk about the app.
That's a weird thing too, honestly.
Yeah, there are some bits of it that I understand. I watched Reggie's GameSpot interview, I think it was, where they asked what the hell's the app about, and he said, "Or why is voice chat done through the app?" Which means it's on your phone. That's a really weird thing when you're used to headsets and whatever. I mean, we use Discord or Skype more often than in-game voice chat. But yeah,
as in we don't ever use in-game voice chat.
I think
ever.
I only used it once with Bill doing something in Destiny because we needed to talk to the other guy. And their reason was, if you're out and about, like, we want you to be with the Switch, and you find yourself in a public hotspot and you see that your friend's playing Mario Kart, you can just voice chat through your phone and play Mario Kart, and you don't need to carry around a massive headset or whatever. That makes sense. What doesn't make sense to me, and I need to see how they deal with this, is they seem to suggest that there's no matchmaking or party making on the console. It sounds like it's solely through the app, which that is a concern for me. So I need to see how they do that and why it's not also on the console.
I mean, the a lot of this boils down to the fact that they need to just clarify and, like, detail this thing. Because, mm-hmm. like, what he's saying could possibly mean, oh, you can enter games, like as a PlayStation 4 party or whatever. You can join a party with someone, and then you could all jump into the same game together. Does he mean that, or does he mean, like, legit matchmaking? Because if, like, there's no... there has to be, like, actual game finding in Splatoon. Like, there's no way in hell they gut that out of Splatoon 2 and make you do it through a fucking app. Like, that would be, like... like, what the hell are you doing? Like, what the hell is that? So, I think that's something different. Like, I think that the messaging and stuff that they're getting across with this app, like, they need to come out and go, like, here's the app, and then show us it and be like, here's what you can do, like, with a party of friends. You can queue up at a party and all join the same game together or something like that, instead of, like here's Splatoon 2. Here's the app. You have to go, fuck. You know, like mm-hmm. there's no way in hell that's true. Like, that's got to be a messaging problem. The voice chat thing is a little strange. I don't really... that's a thing, though, like you said. I mean, like, if it's on the phone, I mean, like, I have Discord anyway, but I understand, though, like, it's for the most part, nobody fucking uses fucking voice chat in games anymore anyway. Like, nobody.
Which always
uses
confused
it.
Me why people were like, why doesn't Nintendo have voice chat? It's like, well, I've never, since Halo 3, I've not used it on an Xbox.
A party, a party voice chat, I think, is mostly what's popular nowadays. And like, I use the PS4 party system like 100% of the time. I'm playing games on PS4. And that's presumably what the app's going to do. I think a lot of people might just want that on the
console. Maybe like, that's what they mean about the party thing, rather than like a game party. Like, if we wanted to play Splatoon as a group,
I think it's just a messaging issue with like getting that across, because they're clearly not ready to show off the online portion yet. They're obviously still working on it, and it's also evident in the fact that it's going to be free for a few months until they fully launch it. So like, they obviously have some things they're working on and making sure that that's good and stable, and they have all the information across. I just kind of wish they wouldn't talk about it at all until they were ready to show it. You know, like because now people are being negative about that for something that's probably just a communication error.
I will say that the decision Splatoon is clearly releasing at the beginning of summer when the online's coming for the very specific reason of people will buy that game. If the online's free to begin with and they can see this is how it works, this is how improved it is, this is what you get if you pay, then it makes a lot of sense to then move into a pay model, because people are going to be so hesitant otherwise to be like, I've bought Mario Kart and Splatoon, I already have to pay for this service, I don't know how good it is. Yeah. Of course, if it sucks, then people have bought Mario Kart 8 and Splatoon and they can't play it, but I think it's a great idea to start off free and encourage people to move to the paid system.
I think a lot of people who are initially down on the idea of this app, I mean, for basic functions like maybe like party chat or whatever, I mean, you know, like that would be nice if it was on the system natively. But I think a lot of people down on the idea of a companion app like this, like, kind of don't realize the fact that literally everybody uses their fucking phone. Like everybody's on their phone. Like, everyone looks at that as the doom end of the world. Like, I use my PlayStation Messages app, like, quite a bit. And, like, I also use my PlayStation app quite a bit to, like do buy certain, stuff. Like, party functions and buy stuff. Yeah, like I actually use that app, like, and, like, I use it often. Like, check and see if friends are online. And if I see friends online playing something or whatever, like, I'll jump on. Like, I do use that app. Like, the Nintendo aren't fucking crazy pants for wanting to make this app a thing. You know,
I mean, I would love the opportunity to look at my phone and see that you or Ebby were playing Splatoon or Mario Kart and to send like a quick message saying, I'm home in 20 minutes if you want to play a game.
The app is a great idea. I hope there's more to it than just the app, and I hope there's a little more on the console. And I assume when they do the full reveal of their online infrastructure, I assume we'll see more. You know, again, that's just something I was initially expecting to see. It's probably my own fault, expectations-wise, but I just figured it was something that maybe should have been shown. But I assume we'll see more, and we'll see it in detail. And the app, the messaging's a little weird right now, communication-wise, with what they're saying about the app. But I there's absolutely nothing absurd about
this
app.
It almost sounds like, because they can't talk too much about the online itself, they can't talk too much about the app as well, and that's why things are getting confusing.
For sure. Like, they can't just come out and go, oh, here's what you could do, here's what you could do, because that would reveal, too much about what they're obviously still working on, like, infrastructure-wise for the online. I'm excited to see whatever it is, you know, because I have a bet with my friend where
if you get the special edition of the most expensive version of Zelda.
If I lose this bet, I have to buy Knack 2 and platinum it.
Oh, God.
So I'm in high stakes right now, Kaneras. I'm in high stakes.
That's pretty high.
I need them to pull through, on this one and have all I need to win this bet is to have a friends list system that doesn't use friend codes. And I think I'm gonna win that bet.
I think I'm gonna win that bet. Unified Nintendo account, possibly.
Exactly. Possibly. They moved towards that Nintendo Network ID thing, like when Miitomo came out. So I am very confident I'm gonna win this bet. Especially with the app and everything, and the way you'll probably be able to add people via that. So, if I lose, well, look forward to my Knack 2 review on next year's episode.
Game of the year,
but yeah, it might be. You know, maybe, who knows? but yeah.
If I can go back about stuff. 10 minutes on the Jim Sterling front.
I've
become the sort of person that is now so hyper aware of how people on the internet work that I too am avoiding watching that video, but I feel like I don't know whether I've become a person that is so like mollycoddled or whatever that I can't hear a negative opinion about something that I care about. When previously I was like, look, if you don't like something about something I like, tell me, I'll accept it. You're probably partly right.
Yeah.
But like Abby said, the title of that video is, it just seems so clickbaity.
Oh, it is.
And I know that everything else that Jim says, other than when he's talking about Nintendo stuff, I understand where he's coming from, and I agree, but he can be so inflammatory towards Nintendo. He'll be saying the stuff that you've just said that doesn't work, or he'll be talking about the prices of peripherals or short stock or whatever, but he'll do it in such a way that
he's actually a cocksucker.
Will be irritating to me, and I don't know if that makes me a bad internet person I can't accept his particular way of saying what you've said.
No, because I think there's two ways to like express criticism, and I think there's ways to express criticism without purposely trying to make the people who are excited for something feel like dicks or like they shouldn't be excited for something. Like, I think the way we did it is fine, and like I'm clearly still excited for this thing, but like I obviously have my issues with the conference and some of the things surrounding it and like the launch of the system. But like there's ways that people come out and like express that opinion, like, oh, here's how Nintendo fucked up and why, and then like that entire video is spent like just being brash and being an ass about it the entire time, like just straight up either insulting the people who work at Nintendo or just kind of heavily implying that anybody who could possibly be excited for this thing are just fanboys or stuff like that. Like, you see that a lot on the internet, and I think a lot of people don't seem to understand the fact that these things are for more people than just one guy or just you. Like, I'm not talking about you two. I'm just saying broadly. Like, these things excite different people, and some people aren't going to be happy with that, and that's fine. And I think hearing different perspectives is fine, as long as that person who's sharing their perspective is doing it in a respectful way and not some kind of fucking joke.
Yeah, I guess, like, that it is a thing of, I will accept criticism, I give criticism, as Effie's full aware of games that she likes, I don't call you a moron. Idiot for liking Xenoblade or Mario 64. It's just that we have a differing opinion, and that what gets to me is when someone applies a blanket statement like, or a judgment of character, that if you like this, you must be an idiot.
Yeah, and like that, like, totally applies to like everything.
Unless I have done that to you, Abby, in which case I apologize.
Well, you said to me before, Xenoblade is bad, and I'm like, no, it's not bad, you just don't like it. about the closest we've got.
That's close, but it's not a judgment on you.
It's a judgment on a thing that I like very much, though.
That's true.
Like, an unfair one, in my opinion.
You can apply it to, like, so many things involving gaming communities, and, like, you know, Jim Sterling does it often, and, like, people, his fans do it often, people on NeoGAF do it often, people on Reddit do it often. Like, just the idea of, like, stating an opinion as some kind of, like, obvious fact, and, like, just, like, saying that there can be no other way that fate has laid itself upon us with these fucking video games. Like, that is one thing that I'll never understand. Like, these things, if you don't like it, if you don't want to buy this thing on launch, if you don't... Okay, fine. State your reasons why. And, like, if they're... Like, they're not valid if you're putting others down to make them. Like, you have your personal reasons why you're not buying them. Other people's reasons for liking it shouldn't affect your reasons for not. Like, on the point of Jim Sterling, like, he's made it very clear that he thinks Overwatch, like... has an overly greedy microtransaction system, and he refuses to play it, and he refused to even put it on like his game of the year list, even though he thinks it's good. It's like, that is the most, like, okay, Overwatch's microtransactions are a little predatory for the events, and like,
well,
whatever,
they were for sure. I think they have definitely improved, and that's something we didn't mention in the game of the year, but their event mentality has improved tremendously.
I wish they were a bit cheaper coin wise. Like 3,000 can be a bit much, but, you know, you finally get enough to buy one, and, you know, whatever. But, like, you have equal opportunity as everybody else to buy, to get these things. Like, not just buy them with money, but to get, you get them through playing the game. It's more than I can say for the absolutely shitty crate system that's in so many other games, where the only way to open the fucking, yeah, is to fucking buy a key. Like, I've been playing Killing Floor 2, and you get these loot crates, and the only way to open the fucking crate is to spend $2.50 to open one goddamn crate to possibly get a red bandana. Like, eat my shit. Like, you know, that's whatever. Mm. But, like, there, like, certain opinions, I mean, like, people will read that. I mean, like, he'll make people feel bad for spending money on the loot boxes or whatever, and, like, call them whales and whatever the hell other derogatory terms there are for people who want to throw money at cash shops. If people want to throw money at cash shops, fucking let them do it. Like, you know, like, I sit there, like, I think the crate system's garbage. I don't think devs should use it. Like, you got to pay to open it. But if that makes people happy and they want to support the dev, like, then whatever. It doesn't mean it's not, it's not, like, making some people happy. Like, I don't know. I mean, I just...
Similarly, though, both Ebby and I can identify this place will make me angry. And I know, based on how people react to Jim's stuff, you know that he can make people angry about certain things. It's like, I know that'll make me angry. I'll do the smart thing and not watch it. I won't go into the thread that's flaming something that I care about because I know that they're not going to have a reasonable argument.
Yeah.
Or that they'll have a reasonable argument, but they'll be doing it in the most unreasonable way. That there's no point in having a conversation with them. It's evangelical almost.
It's common in the gaming community. I mean, and it happens on both sides. I mean, like, you know, like I've seen arguments online from people, like, you know, stating why they may not want to buy the Switch on launch, and I mean, and people will come at them for that. But like, it's Everyone's got their own justifications for things, and that's okay, and just don't be a dick about it, you know. Like, you guys don't hate me now, right? Because I'm buying my Switch in the summer. You guys don't hate me, right?
Not for that reason, no.
See,
I perfectly understand. I'm glad that you're buying it in the summer before. I thought that you'd be someone grabbing it more in the winter because I forgot how much you enjoyed Splatoon. I'm glad that you're buying it in the summer.
I've got a plushie. I've got the amiibo. I've got a little book thing. My friend game. I love Splatoon. Big Splatoon.
Can I have one more moment?
You can have as many moments as you want. Where I just
say to everyone who has said in the past like week since they said that they'd be giving NES and SNES games out for free for a month with the new system. Mm-hmm. Fuck everybody, literally everybody who says, I can just emulate it though. I hate you.
Yeah.
I genuinely hate you. It's illegal, so you shouldn't do that. But whatever, if you want to be a twat, then do it. I don't care. I'll say it. I don't care.
Yeah, that makes
sense. I'm just mad. Yeah. I'm just always mad because that's the one argument when it comes to virtual console. To a point, I understand because like you don't always get every game on there. For example, I think America only recently got Pokemon Snap.
We only just got Pokemon Snap.
No, we've had it for a while.
Oh, have we? Okay. It's just my Wii U keeps telling me about it now. Okay.
But to anyone who thinks that piracy is a good fucking alternative, you're an asshole.
Yeah. I mean, I could be paying for PS Plus to get my free game of the month, or I could just torrent the game.
Yeah.
Very few games are console exclusive. I can get them on the PC. It's fine.
Most of the Plus offerings are, PC indies anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll just screw you, indies. Torrent them, download them.
I think the SNES and NES thing is a neat idea. I think
if they give me Metroid at any point so I can finally play that game, that'd be cool.
Hashtag buy Metroid.
Initially, I was like, you know, like, kind of like, oh, man, it's kind of bummer you don't get to keep them. But at the same time, it's like, if I'm paying for this thing to play online already, it's like everything else at that point is just kind of bonus. And, like, I look at that, like, the Plus games, like, everyone bitches and moans about the Plus games not being Knack or fucking Killzone. It's like, you know, like, you're going to get Knack for free finally. You finally get your AAA game and you're going to fucking hate Knack more than you would have hated Invisible Ink or something. Yeah. Like, I typically enjoy the Plus offerings. I'm a big indie. I love indie games.
I am so glad that the Swindle is on at the minute. Because I've been wanting to get that game for so long that I couldn't quite justify dropping money on it. The fact that I've now got it, I'm gonna love it.
Yeah. I love like I'm always looking for new indie games to play.
I got
refreshing.
Echo and Shadow of the Colossus from it on my PS3.
Yeah. It's and it gave me Yakuza 5. Like I genuinely don't bitch about the PlayStation Plus offerings like a lot of people do. Like, oh, they're not giving us the old Call of Duty. Like, what triple? I mean,
why isn't Battlefield 1 a free game?
You can look at games with gold on Xbox and maybe draw some parallels. Like last month, they got like Sleeping Dogs, like the Ultimate Edition. I'm like, that's a cool, but it's also on sale right now on PSN for $3. So I mean, like, just buy the fucking game. Like, you know, at that point, like, they got that for free. Like, you can get it for the price of half a cheeseburger, you cheap fuck. Like,
so, man, I wish that was half a cheeseburger.
I guess it depends where you're getting your cheeseburger. But like the whole like the SNES NES thing, like that's a bonus for me. And they said like bonus online features. Like I wonder what that could be. You know, like they didn't even say what that could be. That could be something so cool. Like
discounts.
I don't know. Yeah. Like, and that I guarantee you that there's going to be a system where whatever games are on offer that month, you can play for free with these cool online features, and then you get like it like 75% off or some crazy discount or something
or
that like makes it worth it.
Because the coin system at the minute, you spend a certain amount on the eShop, you get a discount on certain games. What some people are saying is you subscribe for a month, you get XYZ number of coins, and you earn enough coins, you get a discount on a major release. That'd be cool.
Yeah.
I would like that.
I would like to see them bring some aspects of Club Nintendo and stuff back into the fold.
I miss Club
Nintendo. I always liked that as a reward system. It always felt really nice, like, to eventually, like, work your way up to a certain amount of coins to get something. And I think it'd be really neat to bring that back, because I know they have that My Nintendo stuff as
points.
Well. Yeah. So, like, it's still there's still a lot of aspects of that stuff, like, wait and see.
Yeah.
So, like, and you know what? Like we said earlier in the show, Nintendo operates differently than everyone else. They could have a fucking Direct in a month that explains all of that shit to us about the online, or some kind of presentation or something out of nowhere that's like, here's Nintendo Online Services, whatever the hell they would call it. Presumably it would have a name. Is there a name for it yet? No?
I think it's just Nintendo Online at the minute.
Okay. Yeah, like, I'm sure they'll have some kind of little thing for it or something, like PlayStation Plus or Xbox Live. I'm sure they'll have something. And like, you know, like we, all these questions could, you know, I mean, yeah.
Who knows?
I mean, it's
Nintendo. We won't know till they tell us.
Yeah. It's different. I mean, a lot of people's expectations for this were them coming out and stepping on stage as if they were Sony and Microsoft, and they did it as Nintendo.
No.
And you could be disappointed with that. Like, I wish it would have been a Direct. Like, you could be disappointed with the presentation. You could be disappointed with whatever. But the fact is, they did it as Nintendo, and like that's what they do. Like, you know, that's how they do it, and they don't give a shit if they please the guy who, you know, like is hoping they come out and do what Sony does or whatever. You know, like they do it their own way, and like it, love it or hate it. I enjoy that side of Nintendo.
Can I throw a point to that moment where Reggie suggested that because Nintendo accounts are a thing, virtual console games will be tied to accounts and not to the console?
Yes.
It was like we're not going to confirm this, but the infrastructure's there. It's like, yes.
more or less confirms it, yeah.
That's awesome. Massive deal from a Nintendo perspective. You could say, well, it should never have been that way in the first place, which is true, but the fact that they've realized it and that they're moving forward in that way is a big deal that that people aren't necessarily giving them the credit for.
They still have my attention throughout the next few months and the few months after launch and E3 and all that stuff, so
I don't think I know anyone who was super into it is now 100% turned off it. I think that they've just been turned off launch day.
The only people who are 100% turned off 100% are the people who are 100% turned off but pretended they weren't.
Yeah.
And the people who were ready to just rip this shit. Because, man, it's really embarrassing. Like, the amount of, like, console warish stuff that still goes on the internet is, like...
I can't
believe
that's still a thing.
Like, really... Yeah, like, it's really, like, you're seriously doing that? Like, I went to a trailer for The Flame and the Flood, the PS4 release, came out this week. it was past week, and I went to the comments. I was like, oh, I wanted to buy that game on PC, but it's coming out on PS4, like, with, like, some improvements. Like, sure, I'll buy that. And I go to the comments, and one, the guy is totally wrong, because this game was out on Expo and MPC early last year. And two, like, why is he doing this? The first comment, I'm going to read it to you. Hold on a second. Because okay. I have to read this thing in all of its glory. like, let's see here. Flame in the Flood, PS4. Like, and it's embarrassing because this, these are the kind of people who will come on and, like, go to the comments and be like, yes, you Nintendo, yeah, man. And, like just vomit this. Here we go. This is better than anything on the Pooh Box 1. Now, one, the game's on the Xbox yeah. One. Like one. Two, what the hell is that? The
Pooh Box 1? It doesn't even work as a joke. Yeah.
That's like your wordplay.
Because yeah. I don't know why, but it's like, yeah, right. That makes sense. But Pooh Box,
like, and his name is Dobby Potter, and his picture is Dobby from Harry Potter.
Mm-hmm.
I got, who is this guy? Like, why? It. And then up, and here's everybody in the comments. Yeah, the Xbox has like 3 games. Like, are these like. Is that the point?
I'll admit,
the only
since Scalebound got cancelled,
that's a bummer, man. That game looked cool.
It's gonna
a
get
rough.
That's a platinum game, right?
Yeah, they.
Yeah,
own
Nintendo
the IP.
Will fund it. Switch
Yo,
exclusive.
Hey. Nintendo got that Bayonetta 2
that
money.
Worked
Let's
so
go
well for Bayonetta 2. They, I mean, it worked. The game came out, but people were so pissed. Yeah. At this point, I don't understand console wars at all. There's so little
Jesus
between
Christ.
Them.
So embarrassing. Like,
aside from Nintendo, which is always doing its own thing.
Okay, you like video games? Me too. Cool, man.
Yep.
Like I still one day want to buy an Xbox One. Like, I'm not like, I have a PlayStation, that's all I'll ever play. Like, nah, man, I want to play the Rare Replay. I want to fucking play Sunset Overdrive. I want to play Quantum Break. Like I like video games.
I want
to
play
so
six Halo games, seven Halo games.
Yeah,
when
yeah.
Halo 6 comes out. Sorry for that.
It's just embarrassing, and you see a lot of it with the Nintendo Switch conference. A lot of people kind of, yeah, see, it's as good as, yeah. Well, guess what? Sony does a lot of fucking stupid shit. You know, where are you then? You know, like when they come out and just do some totally dumb fucking shit with their PSN. First of all, PSN sucks. So like, you know, like, it's awful. I won't bitch about the Plus offers, but like that is one of the most unstable piece of shit networks I've ever used, and their download speeds are garbage. Like what am I? You're paying. They raised the price last year too. Like as we want to provide a better experience, the price goes up, and it's like okay, it'd be nice maybe if like maybe you did some shit with the PSN, like add some features maybe. I don't know.
I want to reiterate.
Which did prove the features.
I just want to reiterate. It took me 3 whole days to download a patch for a game.
Yeah. See that? Like. And that's not your fault. That's not on your end. Like
a game that they said would not have a day one patch, might I add.
That too, yeah. They delayed it for that reason. And it's
yep.
But no, yeah, like all these people out there like ripping on whatever manufacturer, whatever company they're ripping on, like the whatever company you're sitting there fighting on the battlefield for likely sucks.
Literally
like,
the only
as...
people who have the right to be like, you're all idiots. Are the PC guys.
Yeah.
Anyone on PC, I will admit, you can go, you're all idiots, because you don't pay for your online, your stuff infinite tends to run better, assuming that your bloody port's good, your download is as fast as your internet.
Yep.
Stuff works, the potential for modding and all that malarkey, literally everything is better on the PC, unless the mod's garbage. The port's garbage. And they're all just laughing at us. And I like that.
Oh, I just thought of another game. Aww.
Oh. Yeah, what?
From the...
Yeah.
Oh, no.
I forgot to bring up Dragon Quest Builders.
Oh, no!
Oh.
I was going to bring that up, too.
We sent, what, 20, 30 hours into that game?
Yeah, I just completely forgot about it. Because I was just thinking to myself, I wonder if the Dragon Quest Builders got a patch. I might play that later. If it
so, Anna, On another note, for anyone who doesn't know what the hell we're referencing, we did our previous episode, which should be up at the time you're listening to this.
We go out of sequence.
It's some Haruhi stuff. We talked about our favorite games 2016. Yes.
No one talked about Dragon Quest Builders as a spoiler.
That's really disappointing, actually.
There was so much stuff last year. You're just gonna forget about it.
Yeah, 16 was awesome. It's an awesome year. Speaking of that, though, we kind of talked about the Switch and we kind of went on our tangent about how online communities are so shitty and toxic. Off the Switch, though, since I feel like we have a little bit of extra time here, we can spend like maybe 20 minutes or so just briefly going over it. Are there any games non-Switch related that you guys are looking forward to this year?
I'm kind of interested in Horizon Zero Dawn, but I'm going to be waiting a little bit because I need to, you know, save the Switch. But as soon as, like, some good reviews are out and I've finished Zelda and I'm happy with that, I'll probably pick up Horizon Zero Dawn for sure.
I foresee that the autumn will be a time of me picking up a lot of stuff, just because the autumn seems a little bit quieter on the Nintendo front. Aside from bloody Warriors, so I'm looking forward to. I'm interested. I don't know if I'm looking forward to any of it, but I'm interested in For Honor. I'm interested in Horizon.
Ukulele comes out.
Ukulele.
Oh yes.
Which hopefully before the end of this month we hear about how they're doing the Switch version.
Yeah.
It's going to be a little bit delayed by the looks, but I'm fine with that if I can get it on the Switch.
State of Decay 2 apparently comes out this year as well, which I'm excited for.
In
a weird way, because I don't think I can play that game because I have Windows 8, 10, 7. I have Windows 7. I went through a lot of numbers there, but 7 is the one that I have.
I'm looking forward to... I'm intrigued by Wildlands. Tom Clancy...
Yeah.
Ghost Recon Wildlands. Interested in that.
I don't feel like there's been a ton announced that I'm super into.
It's on the Switch, but and doesn't have a date for us yet. But I'm looking forward to playing I Am Setsuna. It's March in America, 2017 in Europe. So maybe I'll import it. I don't know.
Yeah, we can do that now.
Oh. Yeah. Screw you,
Jennifer. Yeah, did we mention that at all? We were talking about the.
It was.
The
I inferred Switch? It when I was talking about Zelda. The Switch is mostly region free. They seem to imply that if the dev chose for it to be region locked, then they could, but that on the whole, it was back to the days of the DS. Region free.
That's awesome.
I'm looking forward to the Animal Crossing game. On phones. I don't know what it's going to be yet. But...
Oh my god, that's probably going to eat my life. Like, I really like mobile gaming. A lot of people are rip mobile gaming, but like, I think games that are made specifically for phones and like, that are, like, that's, like, I like Reigns. Like, I love all those stupid little RPGs. Like, I play a lot of Grand Blue Fantasy, which is getting an anime this year. I'm pretty excited for it. and like, I'll finally get to play Mario Run in March.
I'm looking forward to that.
And
Fire Emblem Heroes. Fire Emblem Heroes in 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Like, I think
I'm gonna drop so much money on that game when I'm in a position to. I'm gonna be like, give me all them gachas.
I'm really glad they kept at it with like the strategy RPG gameplay too for the phone game. Like, from what I understand anyway. Mm. And didn't like make it like oh it's just turn based battles or like oh it's just whatever like.
It looks like Fire Emblem Diet Fire Emblem.
Yeah, it's and like they had the perfect formula with the amount of characters they have to make a gacha game that is successful. Like, people love the characters in Fire Emblem and they love like that entire system they put into place with Awakening that like it works so well as a phone game. And I'm glad they didn't go like chibi or anything like that either. Like,
well, they sort of did with the sprites on the overworld map, but the overall artwork of it looks gorgeous and I'm really excited for it.
But like Animal Crossing, there's so much potential for a mobile game there. Like, I don't know, like I'm in for whatever the hell they do. I just want to hear more Animal Crossing music. Like, just give me it.
It's been so long since, well, I guess we did have the Amiibo update, but it's been so long since New Leaf now. That came out in 2012, I think. 2012 or
I'm looking forward to Ni No Kuni 2.
Nice if Ni No Kuni 2 comes out this year, I'll be excited for that, but I don't think it will for some reason.
I'm looking forward to Pyre, which is the game from the Bastion Transistor people.
Yeah, game looks awesome.
I'm just looking through the wiki page. I'm looking forward to a game that I just learned exists. It's probably not going to come out in the West for a bit, but there's a new Professor Layton game, Lady Layton, the Millionaire Ariadne's Conspiracy. Sounds pretty cool. Dreams might finally come out. Cuphead is supposed to come out this year. We might finally know what that game's like.
Cuphead is one of those games that I feel like has already been out for like 6 years.
Yeah. Persona 5.
Oh yeah, Persona 5's this year.
Probably gonna try and pick up the Kingdom Hearts remix again, give it a go.
Let me know how it is, because apparently it plays a lot like Final Fantasy 15, so.
Okay. I think that's it. I'm just double checking again. I think that's it.
How about you, Bill?
Oh, Snipperclips.
Snipperclips.
If no one knows what Snipperclips is, it is going to be the best couch co-op game in the launch window for the Switch. It comes out at some point in March.
That game looks fun.
To be announced in March. It's basically a co-op puzzle game where you cut your friends up, your little construction paper people, you cut your friends up into different shapes so that you can solve puzzles, and there's a 15-minute sort of treehouse element on Nintendo's YouTube channel. If you've not seen anything of it, check that out. Goes through a few levels, gets the concept across. It looks amazing. And I look forward to being really pissed off at Andy about it.
Yeah. That game looks fun. It looks like you could really like hate whoever you're playing with too, though. Like, no,
oh,
cut
for
here.
For
like,
sure.
No,
yeah, yeah, yeah,
yeah. And you start choking them, and yeah, you're in jail. You can take your Switch to jail, yeah. And play Zelda in jail.
Speaking of, Bill, do you remember Super Flash Brothers?
Super Flash Brothers.
They used to make a series of Flash animations and games way back in the Newgrounds days.
If I saw them, maybe.
Okay, they are the ones making Snipperclips.
Oh, wow.
My friend reminded me, or pointed that out to me. I'm like, holy crap, they're still going. Yeah, they did a ton of stuff back in the day.
Look at them now. With a sleeper hit on the Switch.
I hope it's not a sleeper hit. I want everyone to know about it.
Snipperclips. I'm looking forward, well, it's out, I gotta buy it. Gravity Rush 2.
Mm-hmm.
I picked it up this week at some point. I'll probably wait to start it though after I beat Yakuza. I love Gravity Rush 1. Anyone who hasn't played it, the remastered versions on PS4. It was originally a Vita game. Cat is one of like the most positive and upbeat and awesome protagonists in any game, and the music in that series is wonderful. And there's a demo for Gravity Rush 2 out on the PSN if wanted a taste for how it plays. That game's traversal and the way they handle superpowers and it's such a fun superhero game. The best way I can describe it is if Japan made Infamous and made the protagonist not an edgy man, and instead made them a upbeat and fun, positive and inspiring female who kicks fucking ass, and she's super funny, and there's really cool outfits, and the gravity's really fun to play with, and there's new fighting forms, and the story looks really good, and the music's great. It has a mix of jazz and orchestral. It's really good. Gravity Rush 2. Oh, and the language in Gravity Rush. Sorry, I'm just ranting on Gravity Rush right now. The language is a mix between Japanese and French, so when they talk, it's really strange. The way that Japanese is spoken, the way French is spoken, and they just mix it into one language. Like, they're not real words, but, like, phonetically, it's, like, what you do. So it's really interesting. Okay. They did it because they're Japanese devs, but it's inspired by, like, French comics. So it's really interesting to listen to them talk. Yakuza 0, of course. I'm buying that. I already have it bought. I'm looking forward to playing that. Yakuza games are super fun, and it's kind of like my Shenmue replacement, but Shenmue's coming back, so... Then I'm also buying...
Zero's the one that's supposed to be a decent entry point, isn't it?
A prequel to the entire franchise. Okay. And then they're also remaking Yakuza 1 for the PS4. It comes out in the West in the summer. Uh-huh. And Yakuza 0 was made to lead right into the remake of 1. So it's like literally, like if you've never played a Yakuza game before, there is like no better place to start right now than Zero, cool. which is really awesome. And I think that's kind of the strategy with it to kind of get sales. But those games are a lot of fun. They're really wacky and like really like distinctly Japan, which is fun. It's fun to explore Japan as well. It's not often you get an open world Japan game. They're making a strategy version of Dynasty Warriors that like plays like a grid based Fire Emblem game. So guess I'm buying that.
Man, it's Fire Emblem Cross Warriors.
No, it's Warriors Cross Fire Emblem. Really.
Yeah, it's the other way. Yeah, it's going it's going reverse. That looks a lot of fun. It's called Dynasty Warriors Godseekers. A lot of people are like, "Where's all the hacking and slashing?" It's like, well, it's not Dynasty Warriors.
You've got to imagine
9,
it
so,
in your mind.
We're also getting Neo, which I'm super hyped about. That's probably going to be one of my game of the years. I'm buying For Honor. I'm going to get Horizon.
What for reference, what are you getting For Honor on?
PS4.
Okay, so if I grab it and I want to pretend to play with you, I'll grab it on the PS4.
Yep.
One day this won't be a running joke.
I'm probably going to get Musou Stars because, I mean, I don't know if it's coming out in America, but... let's see what else we got here. I'll probably get Nier. Fuck this year. I want to play Nier Automata. Mm. Mass Effect's coming out. I actually really want to get that Kingdom Hearts PS4 release, the 1.5, 2.5. Like
my only problem is that I remember trying to play 1.5 Remix on the PS3 and despising the first boss because I'm pretty sure I ran into there's a bug in this game. And I'm the only one experiencing it. And I don't like how travel between worlds is done in that game. But people love that story so much. I'm like, I've just got to break past it, I'm sure.
When you walk away.
Yeah.
I'm also going to probably pick up Persona. Obviously, Yooka-Laylee. If Shenmue comes out this year, that. And Destiny 2.
Oh, crap. Yes.
Yeah.
Man, it's a good time to be really mostly into poor. Nintendo games. And
it's time to be poor. I'm into Nintendo and other stuff. I am screwed.
I couldn't wait on the PS4 stuff. That's fine. I'm good.
like
maybe
that's
not
kind
Persona
of...
5 though, because that'll go out of print.
Like that's kind of like as I'm looking at this list, and like why like you know like my reasons for not maybe getting the Switch on launch aren't like. Like vendetta reasons, like motherfuckers.
Like
it's really mostly because,
no money
like,
or time.
Like I am like a lot of these games I've been looking forward to for a while, and like I want to buy them. And then like right up around where this ends, like Persona 5 comes out in April, as does Yooka-Laylee. Like from there, there's nothing I want to buy until Splatoon 2. So like from that period on, depending on how much in debt I am, and how much I'm getting chased by loan sharks and whatever. That is where I start saving for the Switch, and then given Splatoon 2 comes out like in the beginning of summer or whatever, like boom, I'm ready to go. This year's nuts. Like I don't understand like what's happening. And then 2000 the new Valkyria game is coming out in Japan in January, which is already announced to get localized but as digital only and no voiceover. So that could potentially be turned around before the end of the year and put up digitally for America by like the summer, which like fuck, I gotta buy that too because I'm a big Valkyria fan. It's like god damn it.
Oh, I'm also interested in Ooblets. I don't know if it's fuck gonna it might not come out this year, but I'm interested in that.
What's Ooblets?
I will read the about page. What is Ooblets, you might ask? Ooblets is a currently in development creature collection and farming game. It's sort of like Harvest Moon meets Pokemon meets Animal Crossing meets the weird, awkward people we are. Yeah. So I'm following the development of that.
What's that on? What's that
it'll
on?
It'll be PC for the moment. It's a little indie thing, so it might take a little while. But progress has been good. So hopefully it comes out this year. Otherwise, next year.
Awesome. Well, we have a crazy,
on the Switch.
Crazy year ahead of us. I don't know how we're going to make it through it alive.
I don't know. This time next year is going to be awful because we struggle to remember the stuff that came out last year. And this is going to be ridiculous.
Yeah. Well,
I'm going to have to actually write down everything I play.
Well, maybe we can do a top 10 next year if it's that bad.
You know what? Because there's so much coming out this year, we really do need to record once a month.
Yeah, probably. Yeah.
Because otherwise we'll have 3 months to go through and we'll be like, I played 30 games. I remember two of them.
I would like to do one on Zelda, like what around the time that we've played a bit of Zelda, so we can talk about that properly.
Probably around the end of March time, I guess.
Yeah.
March, April time.
When Bill finishes Final Fantasy. Out from the 6.5 hours of recording that we've done. Mm-hmm. Yeah, when Bill finishes Final Fantasy, I'd love to do sort of like a mini permadeath episode on what everyone thinks of the ending and
spoiler
trying to explain plot holes to each other. Yeah. I love spoiler casts. They're so fun.
I do too. They're fun to do.
It's because it's one of those times where I can say whatever I want in regards to a thing.
It feels good.
It doesn't matter because I'm having a discussion with someone.
Yeah.
But yeah.
I'll honestly have that finished by the end of the weekend. So
this weekend.
See you next
week
then.
Yep. Yes. Yeah. I'm not doing anything after I stop recording here besides like making sure my files make it to Kinross, and I'm not doing jack shit tomorrow. So.
I can tell you what I'm doing tomorrow.
What's that?
Editing and grinding.
Buying The Last Guardian. Baby. And playing The Last Guardian.
There's no room in my budget because I just bought Overwatch for a third time.
Well.
Yep.
Well, thank you very much. It's, I'm personally hoping that this came out okay. We've never done two episodes in one day.
I think we're solid, man.
Aside
we're
from like
solid.
E3 stuff when we're watching and we're referring to stuff.
I feel like I've been through a day of E3 right now because I've been sat at my computer literally for the last 6.5 hours.
I feel like I went to work.
Yeah, it does feel like that, doesn't it?
It does. It's weird. So I hope that it sort of came across well. And that I always feel this, but I feel like the last hour we've been particularly all over the place as the madness starts to set in of talking for 6 hours or listening to people talk for 6 hours. So
that's fine. If anybody can't understand our incoherent babbling by the like hour and 15 mark where we probably start ripping on people who are mean on the internet in a mean way, or at least mostly what I did.
Yeah.
It's okay.
You know what? That's what the comments are for. Point out the stuff that we left half finished or didn't explain properly, and we can address it next time.
I think we did a bang up job. Covered all our bases here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We need to switch.